I believe with that, that is that.
Hello!
This is a live stream homebrew game called Legends of the Drowned Isles. I am the host and GM. I'm Mark the Encaffeinated One.
I like it.
I've done a little bit of upgrades for folks who haven't looked at the screen for a while. Continuing to try to create more updates. This is a homebrew D&D 5th ed game. At least that's primarily what we're doing. I'm not going to limit it to that potentially in the future. Who knows what future might bring. Future weird and all that. If you are joining us or watching us live on Twitch, or which is the first time to do live on Twitch today, or on YouTube, where the videos will eventually end up, thank you for joining us. I hope you're going to have fun, as much as fun as we have, playing this game. And who are we? Well, I've introduced myself. Let me let my players introduce themselves.
Hi, I'm Jody. I'm going to be playing Clarg, the half-orc bar fighting rogue. And
You almost say bard?
it's very cold.
Yeah, maybe that's what it is. I'm playing Clarg.
Hi, I'm Marie. I play Elzera, the wood elf druid.
I'm Pat. I play Ironbound the Gobold.
Hey, I'm Nax, and I play Zacchaeus, half-elf wizard.
So, as we begin this session, the group has fallen into the shadow, a strange realm of what looks like infinite time and almost infinite torture. Not torture as in painful manifestations, but torture as in the unchanging nature of the world. It is a pretty awful place, but they've talked to a few people with hope and seen a few challenges along the way. Currently, the group is traveling to the Grove, a legendary grove where the one and only plant they've heard of in this entire realm actually seems to be grown, a wild thornberry. The grove seems to be run by someone who at least Elzera has heard of before, Bernard Cotton, a halfling who was, in some ways, the gardening wizard behind and the underground gardens grown by the halflings. Way back when, in the prehistory of the game, if you've not watched it up to this point, there are 28 episodes on YouTube. There's lots to watch already, and the game went back a couple of years before that as well. On their way to the grove, they were flying through the air, but managed to get tricked into going a little closer to a large Balhanath. In that experience, they also had a few other odd occurrences. For example, Clarg, seeing what at first he thought was a vision of his sister, but then seemed to be something else, as she persisted a little bit after the Balhanath had passed. From there, you rescued a few people. Two of them, Agatha and Martin, agreed to travel with you because they were actually on their way to the grove before they having been captured by the Balhanath. Along the way, however, a small but pretty significant flight of dragons flew overhead into the Festering, this enormous forest of twisted nature, which exists along what we'll call the western edge of the shadow. North being determined by the two red glowing eyes of Ember Skull, the supposed city in which the demon lord, misunderstood god, you don't really know, but Turo, anyway, lives. On the way, we went to the Temple of Mnemosyne that was found here. A squat white temple where the place was somewhat under, I won't say under siege, but there were a number of unfortunate creatures milling about outside. And a very concerned speaker, Orda, waiting outside trying to figure a way in. The group found a way in, maybe the hard way in, using both stealth and trickery and great fighting and good effort, managing to get everybody inside the temple. However, Clarg was stuck outside, surrounded by enemies. And at that point, from within the temple, came the high priest, or the high priestess, Aina, dressed not as they had seen the Namazani priests dress before. Typically, they had been dressed in very simple white robes, almost meditative robes. But this one dressed for battle, full gleaming battle armor, shield and sword at the ready. And she walked out into the fray, seemingly blessed by Orda before she walked out. And then, while the fray looked the worst, and somehow Clark came back a second time from his fall, half-orcs with extras, Aina, well, you might say detonated. Small globules of light, small little wisps, float off of her until the entire area was encompassed in this white glow. And when it had faded away, so had she, but all the enemies had been felled. And Clark stood once more amongst all of this, on the horizon, approaching for some time, and now passing below the dark cloud level, you see a spherical creature. Some of you have fought beholders before, of one form or another, and you've been victorious. But this one seems larger than any you'd encountered before, by a significant margin. And it seems to be coming this way, with the rest of you inside the temple. Aina, not pausing for a moment, sorry, Orda, not pausing for a moment to mourn his fallen friend, asks all of you, "Quickly, help me. Help me move these stones into the entrance." And leading you off to the side, there are indeed large gray stones, which on Orda's own, he can't muster to move them out.
I will
help in any push. Way I can.
Okay.
I bring my tiger in.
Okay. Your tiger retreats back from the middle of the fray, a little bit confused and maybe taking a few tentative swats at these downed creatures that were now rapidly dissipating, leaving behind only those shards which Clark, having been up close to them, actually noticed, a few of them lying around on the ground. The tiger bounds in easily through the entranceway, and collectively, you're helping Orda?
Yeah, I think so.
So these are quite large, significant stones. Well carved, not complicated, but as Orda directs you and helps you to ease these into place, they seem to lock into the front arch. And you can see that there are additional carvings in the upper arch to lock it into place.
While they're doing that, I'm going further in.
Going further in?
Mm-hmm. Okay. I'm 2 feet tall. I can't help them with the big stones.
Okay.
My tiger.
As they do, as the stones come into place, you notice there will be a gap of about an inch, but that allows you to see outward. You can still feel the presence of the magical barrier that had been there. It's still in place and seems unimpeded by the stones themselves. You hop on back the tiger. Do you have animal handling?
Yes.
Okay. Gripping onto the tiger, and this, have you ridden your tigers before? Is this something new for you?
Probably not.
Not new?
It's fairly new. He probably would have had it under the colt, so it just depend on what they were using it for.
Nonetheless, he might have ridden them before. The enthusiasm is there as you grip on back the tiger and begin to direct it around the corner. Make a wisdom saving throw. And make one for your tiger as well.
Nope, I got a 1.
Yeah.
Tiger got a 7.
Okay. And you see the tiger with Kuzaima. I think you're in your natural form, are you not? Yeah. Zipping around the corner, and the sound of the footfalls disappears quickly after. You find yourself on a turn, and then there's just a long hallway that stretches on for 50 or 60 feet. No features on the walls that get increasingly white as you get deeper in.
I will stop after a bit. I don't want to get too far away from them.
Okay.
That's
stop after a while and kind of look back, and it looks just as long and behind you as it does in front of you now. But you didn't really think you went that far?
Damn, magic.
Is there any trouble that he can get into?
All sorts of
guys. Yeah.
Orta kind of looks over and just sort of frowns. He should be fine. If not guided, the temples tend to just misguide people. It's for safety, mostly.
Okay, so I'm 60 feet around the corner?
About that. Okay. It feels that way.
I am going to... I would have sent this to Clark, but Clark was acting really irrational today. I'll send it to Elzera. I'll message her.
Okay.
Say, you all need to get further into the temple. That beholder can cancel magic. It may be able to cancel the barrier.
Do I get that?
Message, yes, because it's all staying local.
He's worried about the barrier not holding because of non-magic, like magic canceling stuff.
Southorp does have that ability, but that's one of the reasons I wanted the stones in place. Once inside, I don't know how he'd react to this place, but he's pretty clever. And you can now see, if any of you look out through the crack, you can now see the beholder kind of swiveling, moving over. And every once in a while you hear this ting, and you kind of look and you can see that the little small spikes are being dragged up and then carefully put into a pouch on the side of this beholder. You now notice this beholder, which is a fairly large object, probably about the radius of this table, which has a ginormous red eye in its center and a large, wide mouth full of teeth. You've heard of beholders before, at least some of you have heard in stories, some of you have faced them down, and you're familiar with seeing the different eye stalks on top, each of them moving in different directions. Around this one, however, what's rather strange is down by the left side of it, just a little bit back from its mouth, you actually see that it has a humanoid hand attached that looks fairly long and slender and pale. As the eye stalks move around, you see one that seems to be responsible for picking up the different metal or whatever they were, stone or metal spikes that were in the Sorrowsworn, the ones that Clark had noticed up front, carefully depositing them in the bag. Meanwhile, the eye is actually swivel looking around the area around the battle and comes to look down upon what remains of Ina, which seems to be nothing more than her sword. Her armor, herself, her shield are all gone. And you hear him musing outside. What do we have here? Oh, no, she wouldn't do that. We had a deal, you and I. Terrible. And then it kind of swivels back towards the door, and you can actually feel the rocks settle in place as the field that was there seems to diminish, and there's a bit of air transfer you weren't aware of before, like almost a suction change, as the energy you had felt from that barrier dissipates for the moment. That same eye stalk that had been picking up the different pieces now has levitated that sword and brings it over and puts it into the pack. And it slides into this pack, which seems only about a foot and a half deep, but the sword slides in quite nicely. So, does that leave just you, Speaker Orda? What a pickle. Is that what they say? I think they still have pickles. You have others with you, then. You couldn't have managed all this mischief on your own. Ada's just kind of looking frustrated and a little worried, not really knowing what to say.
Should we say anything, Ada?
Orda?
I don't know. Orda is inside. Ana is the one who's dead. Yeah. Remind me never to name my characters that close again. But Orda says, I didn't know about a deal. I don't exactly know what he means.
Come, come. Are you just going to hide in there all day, or shall we speak like civilized beings?
But we can hear each other fine from behind the wall.
Ah, there's a voice I don't know. Let me introduce myself. I am Salthog, the opportunist, some say. You are new here, I suspect.
Yes.
That itself is kind of interesting.
Fairly new. What was this deal you had with the priestess?
Well, I can extend the same deal to you if you'd like. I've been looking for something rather special. And I believe that the priestess and possibly the speaker knows where this thing is.
And what is this thing?
Well, it's a trifle, really. It's just a seed. But it has a few special properties I've been hinted at anyway. And I'd rather find it before that large black buffoon Governetta finds it. That would be unfortunate.
Governetta, the dragon?
No, yes. Rather unpleasant demeanor and a terrible smelling breath.
Yes, we've noticed.
Indeed. Now, I have addressed you with my name. Who might you be?
I'm Zacchus, and Lana Porter, from Vatur.
Ah, Vatur.
Yes, it's not in this world.
No, I've heard of it. I want to go there someday. I hear that it's got interesting things.
Well, that depends what you consider interesting, but yes, it does. There's a wonderful library.
Ah, that sounds intriguing. Tell me more of your library. Do you have many interesting books that are beyond farming and dance?
I believe we do, but some of them I don't have access to yet. So I'll have to get back to you on that.
Ah, you sound like a reasonable person. Perhaps we can work together to find this seed. It may just prove our tickets, our mutual travel voucher to Vatur.
I would have to consult others first.
There are others, then. Good.
Why were these creatures who seem to be under your control trying to kill us?
Well,
believing that you are going to kill us is... it kind of puts a damper on our relationship.
These things are primitive. Long since lost much of their souls and minds. They are weak instruments. Usually quite effective at holding something present. They may have overstepped their boundaries. I shall seek better instruments in the future.
Now look at the hole in my robe, and it's like, yes, they definitely have overstepped their boundaries.
If only we had met under different circumstances. Maybe, though, we can amend that. Tell me, who else is with you?
I'll look around at my compatriots.
Kazima's not there. Kazima is somewhere else with a tiger. Is Kazima just staying there? You can vaguely hear the sound of voices, but they seem muffled from this distance.
I'll head back.
Okay. Surprisingly, even though it took you a few minutes to get here, it takes you but 10 seconds to return, and you come around the corner to hear this speech going on.
I'm not talking.
Okay.
Clark will look at Zacchus with bloodshot eyes and spit a sizable amount of blood on the floor at his feet. And say nothing more.
What?
I'm going to sneak up out of sight of through the crack.
Mm-hmm.
And then just peer around through the crack.
Okay. You can see back kind of at the edge of the battlefield, kind of hovering over where Ina was, this creature.
How far away?
What do we got there? Looks like about 30 feet. 30 feet.
Does it see me?
Are you hiding?
Mm-hmm.
Well, she'll have to
do
see.
Do I get advantage for cover or just normal roll?
You will get advantage for cover, yes.
Okay.
weaknesses. We got 11.
Well, wow. That's good, because, yeah. Oh, there we go. 22.
Okay. For a moment, you feel like it sees you, and then its eye twitches, and it seems like it's just looking around.
Okay.
It might have seen motion. Okay.
Hallucinogenic dart to its eyeball.
Okay. Make your attack roll.
And I'm just here like...
Do I hear?
Natural 20. Made you blink.
Okay.
Shoot, I forgot to say I was going to take the minus 5. Okay. Well, that's... Hey, maxed out on damage. Oh,
oh my god.
And total damage twice, too. Almost. That's 11 piercing damage... And whatever you want the hallucinogen to do, it's probably a con save. And you mentioned the effect was like the spell, but...
He's going to be tripping.
It's not going to be a high con save, so he'll probably make it.
Right. Yeah. So, Southog is outside talking and asking questions. And then you kind of see your little friend dive around the corner. Yep. Barely a sound at all.
I'm the only person who's you.
And a second or so later, there's a sort of,
my apologies. One of my compatriots does not take kindly to your kind.
And actually, at that moment, you can actually feel the restoration of the magical barrier in front of you.
Deep speech, I say, "You will die if you stay."
Oh. Who's that, then? Another one of your unfortunate friends, Mr. Zakis?
Yes, but he doesn't seem to make himself want to be known, and I'm getting dirty looks from my other compatriots, too, so... But, so, I guess the opportunity for a deal is going to be difficult, if not impossible, and also, what guarantee do we have that you won't just kill us once we open these doors?
Well, since I've been attacked, I would ask also for guarantees in the other directions. I had hoped our mutual interest would drive forward certain business, but now I see that you may not be trustworthy. Unless, of course, you were willing to eject the guilty party.
What language is it speaking?
It's speaking common, in fact.
Well, we can't do that. Why do you seek the seed?
I shout out, "If you come in, I will kill you."
Well, I'm getting conflicting messages here.
I say that in common.
Okay.
So why? I know it looks at Kuzima. He's got a dead serious expression on his face.
If anyone looks at the beholder, he's got a not quite so serious expression on his face, actually. It almost seems amused. And you can kind of see that it has the hand, which is attached, up and kind of reaching gently to pull the little thing out of its eye and kind of examine it and hold it there. You notice the hand kind of peering at the thing. That's, you've heard of these things? That's never been something of the story. It's so strange.
No, I'm figuring it goes with all the other weird extras that some of these things have had.
How did you get the hand?
It was a gift from a patron. I can further gift you if we were to make a deal. I'm sure there's something you need.
I pull Clark out from in front of the door.
Okay.
Not hard to do.
And I give him I'll back up as far away from the door as I can just to make sure that I'm out of range of this non-spell thing. And I'm going to...
No, the barrier has returned.
The barrier has returned.
Yeah.
Then I'll cast a level 2 healing word into the Clark.
What word does Elzara use?
Stop being an idiot.
It comes out as all one word.
It's a very strange spell.
Yeah. In Elven, it's only one word.
So Elven is German in
that? Yeah, there you go. Oh, if only I'd thought of that earlier. 10. I would have had all of my elves speak with German accents.
Well, no, if they're German, they have to speak with British accents.
Oh, right, sorry.
Clark reaches a hand. Like he's looking for something when he points to the little box.
Oh, yeah.
Little box at your feet.
Yep. I give it to you.
Okay. Clark will press the amber statue into your hand in exchange.
Sort of. People who pay you to do things.
If I'm to drop again and I do not return, take this box to Amarin. He'll know what to do with it.
Okay.
And for those who may have just joined us on Twitch, what is the amber statue?
It's a statue of a tree.
With a seed in it.
It's about a foot tall or so and has a seed in it. Mm-hmm. Not related at all to whatever's going on out there, yeah, of course.
Who knows?
And Elzara had given it back to Clark, who had given it to Elzara as a gift because she had given him daggers. And she had given it back because she was convinced that he was mad at her.
Basically, he's been regifted a couple of times.
Everyone's going to get like a pillar and a amber statue and all this. I was like, huh.
What do I do with
the heck do I do with these? I'll put them in the rec room.
Is it still sticky?
Not quite as much as it was before, actually. It's kind of solidified, a little more solid.
Interesting.
Solidified, a little more solid. I know words, and I use the words to word.
I forgot what patrons meant, so that's why I didn't say anything else to the beholder.
Ah.
So what seed do you seek, and what does it do? Do you have any idea where it might be? I'm assuming it's in this temple if you keep trying to get in.
Oh, how disappointing. Here I thought you might know a few things that would be useful to me. Alas, it is hard to find good help.
I interrupted with a dart to the eye.
I learn new things on the daily basis, okay. Assuming days.
He's not looking directly at the thing anymore, and your dart bounces off the magical barrier.
Ah, yes. Okay.
I remember that. And lands at your feet.
I do learn very quickly.
Do you? Your friend might want to learn a little quicker, too.
I know of your kind. I know enough.
Ah.
I flip him a tiny little finger. Then I'm back behind cover.
And what do you think you know?
I served those like you. I will never serve them again.
Oh, how interesting. I wonder what you are that you have served my kind before. Interesting indeed. Well, if I have aggrieved you, I stand, well, float in apology. But I can assure you that was none of my doing. I have been here for a considerable period of time, and I'm tired of it. The seed... So the stories have gone, and pitiful few stories seem to remain. Some are carved on walls, and some few people still seem to remember ancient times. None, perhaps, as best as those who don't speak, like that blasted Baturo. But the story tells me that the seed is of a very special tree. A tree which once reached between one realm and another. It had a name. It probably doesn't mean anything to you if you don't know of the tree.
Yggdrasil?
Oh, you have heard a few things then. Perhaps this library is worth visiting after all. Yes. It was called Yggdrasil. A mighty tree, so they say. Big enough to go through the crust of this dismal world.
And with the seed from this tree, you could escape the shadow.
That is the plan.
So could we.
Yes. If you were to aid me, I would find it in my somewhat wounded heart. Aid you as well. Despite the damage you've done to my other associates. But, frankly, I'm not really pleased with the reception I'm getting. I'd have to be convinced.
Do you want to say something?
What does Elzara know of this tree?
Do a history check. Or religion.
Let's do religion, because I'm actually trained in that.
I just know we had a branch at the library, and I got stolen.
That I know, but I don't remember if... Either player don't remember. Oh, that's a natural 19, so 25.
Okay. And that's on a religion roll?
Yes.
Okay. The druids venerate trees as a sort of natural part of their existence. But there have been trees which predate the druids, trees of immense power. Trees which have formed the very worlds they inhabited as much as they inhabited them. Yggdrasil has a bit of resonance, and when he mentions the tree that can span worlds, it leads you back to some of the earliest stories that Eldfen told you when you were young about the tree that shaped the world, which was put a little bit differently from what he just said. The idea was this tree may have predated the world, and the worlds were attached to it, like seeds. And then one could travel between the seeds of worlds with this tree. But she could never say what the tree actually was, and she would often admit that it was just a story. At least that's how she knew it. The fact that there was a branch, supposedly, of Yggdrasil at the library was pretty significant, and now reflecting on it, if that was actually a branch of Yggdrasil, that would have tremendous power. How you would use that power, how you would wield it, you're not sure. At the very least, Salthog believes that a mere seed of this tree, if it's a seed in the inverted sense, not a seed of a world, would have the capacity to leave this place. Which, from your experience so far, nothing has been able to leave this place, except for some very, very narrow escapes. Or the original escape, the migration you saw on the walls of the other temple of Mnemosyne.
Okay. Good.
You make a religion or history roll as well.
Sure. I'm trained in neither. 15.
15 for which?
Let's do history.
Okay. In the brief period of time when your mother was living in the same place that you were,
mm-hmm.
Can't really say she was living with you because she was as much busy doing everything else and seeming to be very eager to leave. You do remember one story, and it was of the mighty tree Drasil. The mighty tree which is the foundation of orc knowledge. Mm. The tree made of stone. That's about all you remember, but it does kind of resonate a little bit with what they're saying.
Okay.
So, are we to be enemies or allies?
We're still debating that.
Because I was going to walk back to the two and say, you cannot make a deal with him. Beholders live to dominate others.
Yeah, the fact that he calls himself the opportunist is kind of setting my nerves on edge, but maybe he can tell us more. Salthog, you mentioned Pichiro doesn't speak. Has that always been the case, or did he go quiet recently?
He's a miserable bastard, so far as I'm concerned. Getting an audience with him was difficult, draining, and ultimately futile. He would say little and moaned tremendously. I do not like him at all.
What does he do? He's supposed to be overseeing this realm, but from what I've seen, everything's, well, going to hell, basically.
He rules this place in name alone. If one were smarter, they would find better allies. Take that Arvax. He's cunning. And people are very loyal to him.
No, we've already burnt several bridges with Arvax.
Ah, 'tis a pity. Well, you'll find no love from Givanetta, if that's what you're proposing.
Oh, God, no.
Probably not.
Acid, mainly. Mostly acid.
Indeed, her breath stinks.
So how did you go about requesting an audience with Pichiro? And what was in it for him, if I may ask?
Well, I don't know what he wanted out of it. I made a few pointed threats and made sure that some of his loyal subjects had problems. Maybe a few of them entered my herd as well, at least briefly. Frankly, I think I offended him into having a meeting, but even then he really didn't care.
So who are his loyal loyal subjects?
Oh, you'll find them all over the place. Those moaning, weeping bastards. Some of these were probably among his subjects, too. The Sorrowsworn, some call them. Lost souls, easily manipulated. Nothing more than cattle, really. Cattle with sharp prongs, to be sure.
And once again, you and Orta standing beside the door can actually feel the presence of the barrier go away. The magical presence goes away again.
Anything removing magic is kind of scary.
You kind of end up just sort of even brushing your hand against it. You can almost feel this cold energy or lack of energy, like it's all being drawn out.
Do you know what would make a Pachiro wake up from his pitiful mood?
Frankly, I think he's a lost cause. If he can, I hope he just dies and moves on. Would that any of us could, I suppose.
I heard legends about pillars. I've never seen one of these myself, but apparently the dragon wants them, Pichiro wants them, like white shiny things. Pretty big.
Ah, you heard of the bones, then?
Your bones?
Supposedly. I haven't seen one in person yet. Have you?
Nope.
Make a deception roll.
17.
Hey!
That's pretty good. That's pretty good.
I believe that's, yeah, straight up 17.
Yeah.
Okay. Ooh, okay.
Well, if you did, I'm sure you'd let me know.
Absolutely. Maybe.
Can I make an insight check?
Sure.
No, I can't.
Pichiro apparently was seeking these.
He's very smooth, this strange eyeball.
So what was...
My brain is still on the tree.
So do you know why Pichiro would have wanted these, or does he even still care?
I don't know if he really cares. I think he's given up, to be honest.
Given up on what?
Everything.
I know he used to be romantically involved with Alexia, but...
Wow, you dumb do come with some interesting information, don't you?
Yes.
Interesting.
I'm a scholar, that's what I do.
Ah. You know, I could really use someone with your breed of intelligence at my side. You would be an incredible asset, and we could do anything. Anything that we desired. I have a few things stored away, which I think you'd appreciate as well. Things that would help to increase that smart brain of yours.
Books, enchanted artifacts, objects, weapons.
All of that. I'm a collector as well as an opportunist. Granted, maybe you're bound by other contracts. Shame, really. I suppose you'll end up like all the rest, drained of all hope, and moping around.
Oh, well,
unchanging and unchanged. Have you any scars yet?
What is under my robes is my business alone.
You will. You'll have them soon enough.
Let me get back to you on the seed you mentioned. So if a seed can allow us to leave this place, I mean, back where I'm from, it takes many years for a seed to grow into a tree. Do we have to wait this long? Can we use the seed by itself? What if, could a branch be used if it could be found?
If I had the seed with me, I might be able to answer some of those questions. But I'm chasing the story at the moment. I believe that the seed will grow on its own, once released.
And what about a branch? Would that have enough power to allow one to escape?
A branch of the tree? Such things don't exist.
No, hypothetically, just what do you think?
It would have power if it's truly of the world's tree. Do you have such a branch?
No. Well, I learned a little too late that there was one at the library, but it was stolen.
Oh, this library sounds more and more intriguing every moment. You must come and tell me more about it.
Eventually. Do you come here often, creeping by this temple?
This is one of many stops I make, of my many allies across this realm. But are you going to stay in there for the rest of eternity?
Well, not for eternity. The issue is, I don't know anything about this seed aside from what you've told me.
But I'm sure you'll learn quickly.
Yes. As quickly as possible. Time does not exist here, does it?
It does and it doesn't. Any intelligent being can tell that time has passed. But it grows difficult to know exactly how much, other than by weighing one's own boredom, like with this conversation.
Well then, I take it it's over. You'll be back some other day.
If I must, I will seek my allies elsewhere. And may the best one of us find the seed. And when I do, I'll make another offer to you that you probably would not want to turn down. Good day, Mr. Zachis and Lena Porter.
It was a pleasure.
The Great Library of Vatour. You will be remembered by me.
Well, it was great meeting you.
And there's actually a bow from Salthog with the hand, kind of taking a little bit of a turn.
If we need to contact you, how would we do this?
If you have something of importance, whisper the name Salthog. One of my allies will hear it. And if they do not, keep whispering.
Understood.
I will find you.
I'll nod and bow back to him.
Okay. And he turns and floats up into the sky. Porter kind of visibly just sort of
I do as well. Release. Holding on to this seed in a thing of resin.
Well, he can't come in. So,
basic mood is like...
Guys, so if we have a seed, we could potentially exit this place. Most likely without giving it to... Before I say his name, I'll wonder... Orda, if he said whenever I whispered his name, he would return. If we say his name, does he know?
I mean, I don't really know. I know that he has spies everywhere.
Let's just not risk it.
I don't know who they are.
Just call him the Beholder.
Or he who must not be named, but that's too long.
And Martin and Agatha are kind of back, not quite around the corner. They didn't want to lose sight of you guys, but they're kind of back around the corner, and they look terrified. Is it gone?
Yes, yeah. I believe so.
Oh, I hate that thing. I've never seen it before myself, as Agatha speaking, but I heard of it. Nasty.
Nasty in which way? I didn't want to make a deal with it right off the bat, because, well, we don't know who it is, and what it's capable of, although it can suppress magic, which I do not like at all.
Versatra already has a piece of that tree. Nobody else.
Versatra? With
my aunt.
Okay.
Nobody else who is seeking power should have access to it.
Yes, but I figured if we could... I didn't tell him Arvax's followers had it, or the Wild Hunt had it, but if we could... If he knew, would he... aid us in the fight against them.
He seemed to like Garvax.
I know.
I doubt he would fight with him. He might perhaps join him.
But he is a collector. He would want that branch. He could potentially join up with Garvax, only to betray him later. It seems like something the opportunist would do.
Yeah, I wouldn't bet on it. I don't want to make a deal.
No, I didn't either, especially since we don't know where the seed is, and if we found the seed first, perhaps we could escape. And what's...
I need to sit down with this thing.
Yes, should we go further into the temple, just in case there's things eavesdropping outside?
That'd be better. Follow me, I'll lead you in.
And Orta goes around the corner. Are you all following?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
This time, as you go around the corner, because did I get it right? I'm really hoping I do get it right eventually. The first thing you notice is the corridor is not nearly as long as it was last time you were here. Mm. In fact, it ends at only 20 feet and then takes a right-hand turn. And as you move along, for those of you who are familiar with the temples, and you would have seen it a bit from the last temple, Kozaima, but it seems to form almost around you, taking a left and a right at seemingly random times, but Orta never seems to fail in choosing very definitively one direction or another, especially when coming to an intersection. And within a few minutes, you find yourself in the familiar square central courtyard with the somewhat recessed floor, very familiar to you of these spaces. Orta says, if you'll forgive me, I need to make a few... I mean, there is a part of me which hopes that Aina ascended. And I think that might have been what happened. She said it would happen eventually, that she hoped it would happen eventually. Although I kind of imagined something more like in her sleep. But I have to record some of this on the memory wall, and I have to... I need a few minutes.
I grab him by the shoulder. You've got this.
Make a persuasion check, just as a general...
Can I get advantage for Mama Bear?
Sure.
Well, that is a 10.
Okay. He kind of smiles at you and kind of nods. I can set some tea for you. We don't have much else. There's a few other things that I might be able to get, but...
Is there somewhere I can sit for a moment and set up a little bit of something to do some work?
Well, certainly, if you want to do that here, or I can show you to a chamber that should be nearby.
Here should be fine, and could I get some water?
Oh, most assuredly. I will come back with a small pail of water. Is that enough?
Should be.
All right. So if you excuse me, I'll be back in a moment.
Before you leave, you mentioned going to write something on the memory wall.
Yes.
Is there a mural, like the other temple, that depicts what happened?
Well, you've seen them before, yes.
Yes.
We do tend to keep some of our moments in memory there, yes.
Could I have a look at it, or does it have the same imagery that was present in the other temple in a...
Well, each temple is unique. Each one is a part of the world's memory, not the whole. Maybe it can wait for a little while.
Yes.
I need to be with you, since you're not, I presume, a follower of Namazani.
Not at this
we've
point.
Had some colorful followers, but you seem different.
I'll take that as a compliment. But yes, later is fine.
It was meant as such. If you'll excuse me, I'll fetch your water and I'll be back in a moment. And kind of skitters out of the room.
I start setting up my alchemy kit.
Okay.
Larg will sit down and roll out his pack of weapons and stones and start sharp.
Okay. The ritual sort of...
Yeah.
Getting back to that moment, being in a mercenary company where you never know when the next battle is necessarily going to be, this was a very familiar ritual to you as well, to take these things out and make sure everything is ready and tip-top shape.
He focuses on the glaive, mostly because it's seen the most action recently.
Okay. The glaive feels somewhat warm to the touch, and the larger nimbus of shadow that had kind of been around it seems solidified more in the weapon itself. The voices also seem calmer. But you begin to work away at the blade.
Okay.
As you're setting that equipment up, in a moment or two, he comes back with a pail of water.
I have to roll for setting up the equipment properly. I forget, is it the wisdom?
It should be your proficiency.
Yeah.
Which, it would be, I think, intelligence. No, wisdom set it up, yeah.
That's a 15 on the die, so let's find something that, that would be 23.
Yeah, no problem.
So.
In fact, it's kind of nice to do something normal, and you kind of look over at Clark and realize the two of you are kind of doing the same thing, taking a bit that you know how to work, taking something you're familiar with and setting it up and making in this blank space that is the interior of the temple a moment of yourselves right there. Are the two of you doing anything in the meantime? Mm-hmm. As you can see that they're setting up their respective corners, essentially.
I'm going to pop a dried thornberry into my mouth and put out my bedroll and have a nap.
Okay.
I'm going to call my dolls back to me, too. They can stand around next to me.
Yeah, presumably you brought them in at the end of the fight as well.
Well, they were being carried by the NPCs.
Right, right. So, yeah, you carry them back, and they kind of, one on each side, kind of fluff up your bedroll a little bit.
Yeah, I tell them just to keep an eye out on things and let me know if there's anything that comes in.
Okay. As Kuzaima lays down, you see the... Now, one of them was actually a doll. One of them was something else?
No, these ones, there's a candle and two light healing potions.
Okay. You see them now with their tiny little doll arms and legs. As Kuzaima sits, lays down, they begin a patrol around the bedroll. And every time they run into each other, there's a little nodding bow to each other.
Turn around and go the other way.
Kind of, yeah, yeah. With one of them kind of being fixed, the other two move around, and then that one stops, and then the other one moves around. Within a moment, the pail of water is brought back in order, bows and says, I'll be back. Thank you. If you need anything, just simply call, and I will hear.
What does the eating the dried thornberry do?
You feel a wave of relaxation cross over your body.
Oh, good.
You feel like everything's fine. Everything is okay. It was a rough day, but you're still alive, and, you know, you don't feel like you're in much pain, and, yeah, it doesn't feel that bad at all. An emission of peace, essentially. And Orda goes off to do whatever Orda needed to do.
So, what I was furiously searching here for, I had have done a check before, and I had determined that it was a nut. A walnut seed should not happen... I remember it being, like, something with the outside of it was...
It was only the meat of the seed. Yeah. There was no shell around it, as if the amber itself was almost acting like a shell.
I would like to study this amber and try to figure out what it is.
Okay.
So, like, I was thinking of first examining it as a whole, the amber itself, and then... if I think it is a good idea to do so, I'm going to take a dagger and just scrape off a tiny bit and try to figure out.
Okay.
What?
So you're going to science the crap out of it.
I am going to science. All right,
sounds good. Yeah, so you'll start to examine it, and once you set up your equipment, you'll start to get like a boiling thing going. There's always a boiling thing.
Yeah.
Pipettes, and there's some things, you know, spinning around, and... multiple levels of thing. Who knows what these are doing?
I mean, it's a portable one, so it's like just on a table with like little...
I kind of imagine though, it's like one of those almost, you know, portable shoeshine kits or something where you fold it out and then it folds 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 out.
And then it pops out.
And then you're just sort of attaching things from one side and the other and you get a little fire going and... So you set that up and start going with
that. That is my intention.
Okay, that's going to take a while to analyze that, but you can certainly get started.
I'm going to spend a couple hours. I'm not going to spend too long.
Okay.
But if I see that I'm not going anywhere, we are on a little bit of a time crunch at least, so.
Okay. What are the rest of you? Are you going to...
I'll go next to Clark and... Hey, during the battle...
Yeah.
The cloud of darkness that happened, like it happened during the first fight with the, not Aboleth, but...
When the dragon went by.
Yeah, it was more of a hiding, it wasn't a fight. When the dragons flew overhead, that was one of the things Clark did, is under part of the stone, he created a cloud of darkness around him.
That was one thing, but the cloud was a lot more violent when we were fighting the Sorrowsworn. For a moment, there were so many of them, I feared for the worst, but you came back. What happened?
I died.
Welcome back.
Thank you.
How can you, if you don't mind, give me more details about...
Sure.
What is dying in here? I guess you came back quickly enough to avoid receiving a scar.
It's different here, or... It's hard to explain. I don't think had a vision, briefly, while I was asleep.
Really?
Yeah.
What was it?
I found myself walking among great columns, among the dead. The stone columns stretched up to the heavens, as far as you could see, and there were two types of people who walked among them, other than me. Those that were pathetic and listless, and others with bright red smiles that walked with purpose and drive. And before I could get too much further, I heard a voice, and I was returned to my place here.
Which, was it a familiar voice? What did it say?
It was 100 voices, and they were familiar.
Wow.
And he holds up the glaive and says, and they are in here.
It speaks to you.
It does.
Do you mind if I have a look at it sometime?
If you wish, although I would be very careful.
Don't worry, I will not be swinging it around.
I don't know if they will like you.
Well,
we seem to have some sort of understanding.
We, as in you and the weapon?
We, as in myself and they.
Okay. Do you mind if I attempt to detect what kind of magic is at work?
Do what you wish.
All right. Thank you. I swear I won't cut myself.
Do you need to hold it?
Yeah. I'll cast detect magic on it as a ritual.
Okay. Are you holding it, or are you just going to leave it there?
I'll hold it.
Okay. Make a wisdom saving throw.
Uh-oh. 8 plus 5, that's my proficiency bonus, I think.
No, no, it's 4. Your saving throw.
Yeah, don't I have, like, wisdom plus 4?
It depends on whether, if you have wisdom as one of your chosen saving throws.
So 12.
Okay. You feel, as soon as you touch the handle of this, it's cold to your touch, and almost weirdly distant, as though you're holding it strangely at a couple of meters away, and you can see the wisps of shadow extending around it. Where you had seen it be calmed down and solidified, now it seems to agitate. And in your mind you hear dozens of voices, all inquisitive, asking questions in languages, some of which you recognize, some you don't. The questions are like, oh, who are you? Are you the one? I don't think you're the one. Can you be the one? And they challenge you. And you take 2 points of psychic damage as it seems to assault your mind. Now you can cast the spell still if you wish.
Hmm?
You can cast the spell.
Yep.
So you cast Detect Magic?
Yep.
Okay.
You're right, it doesn't like me.
The primary aura that's around this that kind of continues and expands as you're looking at it, is very, very dark. And as you cast Detect Magic, you can see now not only the agitated shadow around it, but almost meter-long swirls of this black energy. And the energy is very clearly necrotic, or necromantic energy. Very, very strong. There are small elements of, like wisps, a little bit of silver, like silver linings to these dark clouds, and an edge of orange around the handle itself, indicating that there is some element of divination magic and some element of enchantment as well. But you feel overwhelming power. Do you continue to hold it?
Clark, can you speak to this back?
Make another wisdom saving throw.
Yes, we have an understanding. 9.
You take 6 points of psychic damage.
Clark reaches over and puts his hand on the glaive.
Okay. It calms. And you feel the voices kind of dismissing now. More of, no, there's what we were looking for. There's the one. This feels better. This seems like a better vessel.
It calls you the one. And you were right. It did not like me.
It has chosen me, apparently.
That's okay. It seems like a... Not that it's a bad weapon. I've seen what it can do, and it's amazing.
And you can see as the blade on the weapon, the blade normally flat like a glaive, folds upward into the shape of a scythe as you're holding it, and it feels heavier.
Clark will take it back fully now.
And you feel this sort of almost stumble as the connection is broken with you. But then the shadows seem to meld back in with the weapon itself. The blade's still extended, but it makes it easier to actually clean and correct at this point.
Okay. What makes it change shape, blade?
I don't know.
I'll have to look at it some other time when I'm less tired and have less of a headache.
I know that when it does that, it is hungry.
Why would it be hungry when I was holding it?
You're the wizard.
Definitely requires further investigation, but not now.
Now that he has that up, this is not a large, very large room. Does he ping anything off of what I'm holding?
Yes. So as you glance around the room, because
I'm here sciencing in the corner.
Detect magic does last for quite some time. You would detect the amber itself actually seems to almost glow more richly, with additional orange around it, indicating.
Wrong color.
I thought I had the right one. Let's see here. Well, it is going to be some brown edge around it. In fact, the amber seems to be, has flecks of this brown magical energy, which indicates transmutation. Probably indicating that itself was transformed. From the very center of this, however, comes. I've got to check something. It's exciting. I've got to check something.
Yeah. I spent way too long forgetting that this thing existed.
It's a very familiar magic in the center, as you can see. The nut itself contains. Oh, actually, that's not the right one. Yeah, it kind of glows with a nimbus of red, indicating evocation magic. And some brown shot throughout that as well. At first you mistake that for the actual shape of the walnut itself, but then you realize it kind of glows dully brown beneath this sheen of red. And the brownness is transmutation itself, and then it's got a sheen of evocation magic around it.
Okay. And that's for the amber only, right?
No, that's for the whole thing. The seed itself is what has the red sheen over brown.
Okay.
The amber itself has flecks of brown within it. You can make an arcana roll if you want to try to figure out more.
10 plus 14... 24.
Okay. From the way it's layered like this, you get the feeling that the amber was created as a protection around it to keep it solid and stateless. The red probably means that once it gets exposed, it has a protection of its own to prevent it as a last-ditch effort. And then the brown on the very inside is the pure energy of the seed itself, just waiting to transform itself.
Okay. Where did you get this?
I don't know. Ask Clark.
Where did you find this?
I had a friend find it for me.
Okay. Anyway, we'll get to that later.
Me sciencing.
Yeah.
I puts it in water. See how
it does have magical properties. It's like the amber was transformed. It's there for protection. I can detect
something. I won't cut it then.
Won't or can't?
I won't.
Okay.
In the center, there seems to be evocation or something evocation based.
Generally, evocation magic is for a magical effect. Yeah. So fireball is evocation or lightning bolt is evocation. Usually some sort of big magical effect.
Yeah.
Definitely won't.
It's like it would be protected possibly by itself, but not much.
Interesting.
So, what friend found this for you? Was it Bozo or one of Bozo's associates?
He was the one to hand it to me. I'm sure he found it from someone else.
Great.
From where? I have no idea.
Curses.
We generally don't ask those kind of questions in my business.
Right. That's something I can never get used to. I mean, but if you're good at it and it gets us not killed, then all the better.
Clark considers that. phrase. It goes back to cleaning.
Okay. What I was trying to say, it's like, we need charisma people. Because Zacchaeus is not a charisma people.
Says you. If you could, you've determined that this is magical, could you identify it?
Most likely, if you give me a few minutes. I'll cast Identify as a ritual.
Okay. Meanwhile, you're continuing your analysis. I'll have you make an alchemy check, actually, while you're doing it.
Now, I don't have my books with me, but I... No, that's with plants. Never mind.
Sorry?
I have a book that gives me advantage with plants.
Yeah.
So. That is a 19.
19, okay. So your tests show a few things. One, the amber is mostly regular amber.
Mm-hmm.
The evidence you had from before where it was slightly tacky probably means that it was reacting a little bit to the presence of something. You're not sure what. And you think back, and it's probably just this place itself might actually cause it to soften a little bit. It is solid all the way through, and that actually raises a bit of surprise for you because the amber often does have little pockets of air or other things stuck in it. Mm-hmm. This looks pure. Absolutely pure all the way through right to the very center. The surface of it is solid now, no particular problem with it. You drop a little bits of probably acid and water and other things to see what reacts, and almost nothing seems to react much at all. It's very, very hard, and harder than you expect it to be, especially for amber.
And remember, it kind of has the shape of a tree, so I'd be doing this...
Roughly, yeah. It's like a statue almost of a tree.
Yeah, so I'd be doing this, like, on the furthest end from the seed.
Mm-hmm. And even despite kind of putting some of these caustic chemicals, the small amounts that you have there, it doesn't seem to mar or disturb the surface. Given what Zacchaeus had indicated about the transmutation, you feel like this was probably something else before, and amber was chosen as a form to be around this. Knowing what you do about plants, you know that amber can be dissolved and can actually encase seeds for long periods of time that can then be grown again. And given the fact that it looks like a tree, it may have actually been meant to be planted somewhere. But the amber seems to resist any of the chemical transformations of it. Judging from some of your tests, it's actually denser than you expected, as you kind of do probably a volumetric test, basically dump it in some water and see how much it displaces and those sorts of things. So that gives you a volume, and then you do a weight and go, that's too much weight for this volume. So it clearly was a made object, not a naturally found one. Mm-hmm. Now, it's hard to determine much about the actual walnut inside.
Yeah.
It's the amber is a bit like a yellow glass, so there's some translucence to it, but not a lot. But as you kind of stare closer and closer at it, you can actually make out, and I'll give it to you because your perception is bizarre. I should probably just give you the arcana stuff for the same thing. But basically, at this point, because you've also been studying it and because you were using the alchemy, you kind of use a little bit of the caustic chemical just to kind of clean the surface.
Mm-hmm.
And you realize there's actually a kind of grimy surface on the outside that's accumulated. And you look through and you can make out very tiny runes carved into the surface of this walnut that are almost imperceptible. If you hadn't really literally been staring at it...
Anyone have a magnifying glass?
With the blank white walls of the temple behind you, so you actually kind of can see right through, you would never have been able to make them out. However, it is not legible at this particular size. You know they're there, but you can't read them. In the meantime, you've been doing your ritual. Yeah. What did your ritual for Identify look like? Anything in particular? Any notions? What would his ritual look like?
Memorizing it from the
book. Book flipped opening, open.
Yeah, flipped open. Whatever runes or arcane symbols have to be traced, like probably like with chalk on the ground.
Okay.
A lot of quiet like meditation and mumbling.
Okay.
And then eyes just go open and it's like, oh, I know what the thing is.
So Identify seems to be stopped by the amber. You identify the amber as very clearly a protective seed. However, you are now aware, although not of the details, you're aware there is a ritual to awaken the seed. And the ritual will destroy the amber, release the effect on the inside, and then the seed will be released itself.
I can't identify the seed itself. the amber protects it. I can identify the amber, and there seems to be a ritual to make the amber disappear.
Yeah, there's writing on the seed. Really? Can't read it.
Curses. Why, is it an unknown language? Is it too small?
Too small.
Someone put 6-point font on your 12-point document, yo.
If the amber can be really, if the amber can be removed by the casting of this ritual, it'll release the effect on the seed.
Okay.
Which we have no way of finding out what it is until it's actually released.
What if this is one of those seeds?
Yeah, we should tell nobody else that we have this. Just in case. I'm assuming it isn't, because, I mean, if it is, Clark, I need to meet your friends. Or the friend of your friend.
I'm not sure that's a safe idea. You've already given up your own organization to this thing out there.
Well, what's he gonna do? He can't even escape yet.
Not yet.
And if he did, he... Well, yeah, he does seem a little...
Probably
sketchy, but...
ransack your home, kill your friends.
Well, no, the library has defenses.
Us.
What?
Meanwhile, the glaive's saying, I'm okay with the kill your friends thing.
No, I started my sentence friends before you finished yours.
All I said was us.
Yeah. No, but I started the sentence before.
I can ask some questions perhaps at a future date. We need to leave this place.
We do. Is there any chance we can rest first? After we've finished
Well, at that point, about an hour has passed, and Kazima has the benefits of a short rest.
Woo. Anyone else get that?
Those two wouldn't, because they were basically busy doing a whole bunch of things during that.
Right.
You know what? Yeah, I'll give you all a short
rest.
I'm
going to put my candle up, too.
Ah, okay. So with the candle up, it is, I think, maximizes health regain?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, okay. In that case.
Yeah, all your short
is that
rest
one,
dice.
Is that the candle that actually has arms and legs now?
Nope. No, that's just a regular candle that has the arms and legs.
For how long are we...
It kind of looks jealously at this new candle and kind of gives it a small kick. But the candle doesn't fall over once lit. It seems a little jealous.
So for how long are we resting? Can we get a full 8 hours or anything close to that by any chance?
Well, first we got a short rest. Yeah. Then you guys can do whatever.
At the moment, there is silence. The peace of the center of a temple of Mnemosyne takes hold. Orda has not returned yet. But there seems to be no immediate threat.
After an hour, Clark's starting to look a lot better than he was. He's not leaking all over the place now.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah.
That's good.
I'm back up to full.
I'm 1 point shy of full, but I'm not sure if I want to spend a hit die for 1 point.
No.
I'm having a math day. I had to subtract 54 from 104. On paper.
On paper. Well, it's a day.
that is my day, y'all.
It's a day.
So yeah, I'll be doing that. Now I have all of these questions. More questions to my never-ending questions.
I will hold out the bottle to people and say, if you want to rest, take one of these. They're very restful and peaceful.
And this is the bottle of dried seeds?
Mm-hmm. The bottle of dried thornberries.
Yep.
Clark will pass. But thank you for the offer.
Okay.
I'll pass because I'm working.
Well, I wait until after it's been like an hour or so.
Yeah,
so he's had a nap, and you.
Because I was lying down for an hour while you were doing all that other work, so.
I mean, how long do we still have the aid on us?
It lasts for eight hours, so it's still active at the moment.
Yeah, I wanted to take full advantage of those extra hit points, yo.
We were here for a reason. To see if this place needed help before we went to your...
Oh, yeah, don't we have a, thing?
Yes.
I've forgotten about them for the moment, but Martin and Agatha are just off in the corner, kind of talking quietly to each other. Every once in a while, looking over, and you'll notice the glances kind of in your direction from time to time, more looking at the weapon itself.
Yeah, I offer them some berries, too. They're very calming.
They're actually quite surprised to see the bottle full of berries and kind of look at you with surprise. How can you afford all of those? That's a fortune.
I stole it from a temple.
Oh, no. And Martin just sort of shakes his head. Oh, did you really have to do that? That's bad luck.
I thought my friends needed it more.
We'll return the rest, right?
And none for me, thank you. And Agatha similarly declines.
Oh. Hey, Martin. Back in the pocket.
Agatha, do you guys have a magnifying glass by any chance?
I'm afraid what little things we did have were in the wagon.
Juices.
Or the cart, really.
I have a tinkerer's kit, but I'm not certain of how rare magnifying glasses are in your world.
Ground glass is relatively rare, but you did encounter, the rest of the party and Amrun did encounter the magical telescope, so it is possible.
Yeah, no, I'm just wondering, is a description. Kujaima has a tinkerer's kit.
Yeah, there's a description of what's in a tinkerer's kit, I believe.
Not exactly.
Because they did break out some of those. I'm not sure if they broke out that one.
In Xanathar's guide, they have some description of what's in different ones, but the tinkerer's kit, I think, is just general stuff. There's not much of an explanation of what it's for.
Doodads and whatnots.
I would say for sure in a jeweler's kit there would be.
Yeah, in a jeweler's kit there would be the small eye one, more than a magnifying glass. The loop, thank you.
Yeah, but a loop is a magnifying glass, though.
Yeah, but that's usually the one that thinks, I want it over there, actually. Mm-hmm. It's the large one. I don't think so. It's more of you've got some hand tools and some things for adjusting metal and things like that.
Yep.
Larger scale, usually. Order returns. Looking a little slack-shouldered. I've added what I could. But I didn't know Aina that long, to be honest. I've only been here for a while. Feels like longer. Everything feels like longer.
I'm sure you did great.
You might have been here for thousands of years.
Mm-hmm.
There's no way to tell, to be honest.
Mm.
I had hoped to carve things on the wall as a way to kind of remind myself, but Numazuni's walls are not to be trifled with insignificant things like counting off of days. To be honest, I've probably been inside here for hundreds of days and didn't realize it. At least, that's what Aina used to say. I don't have much. I can brew some tea or just bring some water if you'd like.
We had a thing that we were supposed to bring you. Who had that?
It's definitely not me.
Not me?
I guess it was me. Because it was an orb of some sort, right? From the other temple.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
An
identifier or something.
Yeah.
That we were told to bring this to the temple. And we had already told him about what happened at the other temple, correct?
I don't know if you actually had a chance to.
Okay.
Yeah, we just ran. Because
you kind of met him as he was hiding from those creatures, and then went in from there. But you can explain that now.
Yeah.
And he looks delighted to see the orb from the other the symbol from the other temple, but as you mentioned, the ascension of that high priestess as well.
It's ascension time.
He actually gets a puzzled look across his face, and what harm came to her? Why did she ascend?
Nothing.
Was she in a battle such as Aina?
No, she was showing us the carvings on the walls. The history of the world, and I turned around to ask her more questions, and she was gone.
Oh. Oh, well, then that might mean something different entirely.
Maybe she escaped this place.
Well, in a manner of speaking, ascension, if it is true ascension, and not just a disintegration of the body, and frankly, there were some scholars that tried to argue at one point with us as they came through, and tried to argue it was merely just a death, but Aina put them straight, some at sword point, but they got the point, as it were, that
It is a manifestation of Mnemosyne's will. In this place where so many things seem to be so far and distant and even non-existent, the idea of Mnemosyne's will reaching us here sometimes felt, well, impossible. I've had my doubts over the years. But to know that two high priestesses have ascended in such short order, well, that could be very, very bad.
How so?
Perhaps we are a curse.
No, I'll say that. Not
exactly. It happens after we leave, or arrive.
Is this something that frequently happens to you, or just these twice?
We've only been to two of your temples.
Oh, well. Perhaps we can call that a small blessing.
100%.
Yeah.
Oh.
We need a larger sample size to figure out accurate information.
Where are your other temples? We need to test this.
Quiet. There are a couple more, but... and while you will be welcome, and you can carry on that orb from me as well. And he touches it briefly, and you see it glows slightly, then returns back to its normal light. They will understand that you are friends. But if this is the case, forgive me, I'm still new at this, and Aina was supposed to train me on some of this, but she was terse at times. But she spoke of sort of, in a way, our purpose in being here. Why would we be here in this place of any place? And there are elements of peace. There was no temple of Mnemosyne on the island I grew up in, but I had heard stories of them. And when I drowned and awoke here, the temple took me in and nurtured me. But there was something that Ina said once, which comes to mind. How did she put it? Ultimately, we are here to comfort those who've lost everything until there is nothing left to lose. I don't know exactly what that meant, but if the high priests and high priestesses are leaving, I can only assume that Mnemosyne is calling them home, which means our presence here is needed. But I don't know what that means, really. It's probably just a coincidence. Strange things happen here all the time.
Yes.
But, well, I'm sure it was just just losing Ina that... And you can all make insight checks. Sorry.
Can't make those today.
13.
7.
22.
11.
Okay. Zacchus, there's something in the way that Ina is speaking where, obviously, there's a great amount of loss and sort of this... almost lost in thought and memory. But while Orda is putting on a brave face, he was in love with Ina.
Oh.
And it is almost as though there is a cave now within him that he's trying desperately to fill with the things he remembers about her. The little things she said, the bigger things that she did, the things that she never properly taught him. He's kind of grasping at those things.
Well, if she ascended, and now you're replacing her, when you ascend, you may see her again.
Oh, I'm nowhere near that skill. At least I don't think so.
But you can learn.
Kind of. No, I'm still solid. I have more work to do, I guess. Maybe something to do with you.
Do you have a magnifying glass by any chance?
Magnifying glass.
Yes.
Oh, well, I hadn't really thought of it, but...
Or any method to enlarge something so that we can read something.
No, that's probably not a good idea.
One moment, please. I have to check on something.
They've rearranged everything in...
They did.
In D&D Beyond. And it's like, I used to know where everything was, and now I'm not so sure if I know what anything is. Although I found it faster than I thought I would.
So maybe okay. They're doing some good.
Make an Arcana check as you start to describe this.
14 plus... So 28?
28. What school of magic do you have?
What do you mean?
What school of magic are you a wizard?
Oh, conjuration.
Conjuration. So you start to think, I need this little thing. It's only like about this
big. Oh, right.
And
I'll conjure a magnifying glass.
So, with a minor effort as you start to describe to Orda what you were looking for, you kind of just sort of rub your fingers together until it's sort of holding a magnifying glass.
And then you get to teleport over to her.
Never mind. It's been a very stressful day.
Or did you sort of raise an eyebrow? Indeed. If there's nothing else that you need, are you staying? Or do you have to go?
We would... If it's not too much trouble, we could possibly rest and recuperate here.
Oh, over. You're welcome to stay. I could use the company. And you hear on the other side of the room, Agatha says, we're staying. As much as it's been nice to meet you folks and hear a little bit of what the world we left behind is like, I don't think that we should travel with you anymore. I don't think it's safe for us. We barely made it in, and I think that, well, the cost was too high. So I think we're going to stay here and maybe head back after a while.
It's probably safer for you here.
Danger does seem to follow us around for some reason.
It's like we have the PC glow.
Orta just sort of nods and smiles. Then I will make sure some spaces are available to you. You can stay here if you like, but I can make sure that rooms are created for you.
That would be wonderful.
Thank you. And I can still look at the mural later.
Oh, yes, of course. Maybe when I've gathered my wits a bit better about me.
Not a problem.
Is there anything you need from us before we go?
I have from a dried berry.
Oh, thank you. And he actually takes it, and that's a very generous gift. I can use one of these, and he eats it right away. And you can see the instant change from the slumped shoulders and kind of the worried look to the face kind of pulling back into a brighter point of view, and his shoulders go a bit straighter. He breathes deeply. That helps. That helps tremendously.
They're good.
They're more than that. They're hope. Anyway, I think, well, I'll take a look out, but I think all of the bodies will be gone by now. And I don't expect Salthog to come back anytime soon, and he still can't make it inside.
Say his name. Just in case.
I think we're okay inside here. This space is utterly unlike what is out there. But I thank you. And, well, my own supply of berries is low. I don't know if you're heading that way.
No, that is exactly where we were heading.
Oh.
After we brought the information to you.
Well, then I will make an exchange for the promise of some more berries and leaves, then, if you can. That would be appreciated.
Berries and leaves.
I'll have that ready for you. I'll go make some rooms ready for you.
Excellent.
And Agatha and Martin both follow with him. They're quite ready to just bed down.
This the only exit?
Well, no. There's another door over there. You look over, and there's another gapway on the other side, which didn't seem like it was there a few minutes ago. The two of them will stay open, depending on which way you want to go.
If you can lead me back to the exit, I will sleep there.
Why would you want to do that?
In case anything comes in.
Oh. Oh, well. I'm sure nothing is going to come in. And there's a momentary chink in the armor of the buoyant nature that this berry has given him, but it bounces back very quickly. I'm sure it will be fine. You'll be fine there. Certainly. Just come with me, and I'll escort you there now. And he, the panther? Cheetah? Cheetah, wasn't it?
It would be gone, actually. It would be gone by now. Last an hour.
Right.
I wake up and say, thanks, goodbye.
He leads you and kind of leads out the door you didn't see before, and then round and says, just wait here one moment, and leads Agatha and Martin into one room nearby, and then still within sight of you, so you don't lose track of him, leads you back out to the entrance. It only takes a moment, even though it took at least 5 minutes to get here. It only takes about a minute to get back to the front, so to speak. Is there anything I can get for you? I can come out this way and bring you some water, or I might have more blankets if you're cold.
No, thank you. I should be fine.
Okay.
We don't seem to need to eat here.
No, not often anyway. And most people just, well, eat a pneuma and they're fine for a year or however long that is. Hunger doesn't seem to be one of the needs we have here, wherever this place is. Sleep well.
Thank you.
And he returns back for the rest of you.
And I'll grab my conjured magnifying glass. And okay. Do you mind if I look at that?
Can I? Because I know where it is.
Okay.
So I'll take a look at it.
Okay. The magnifying glass brings it all into view. You find you have to kind of clean off that spot again, almost as though it intentionally obscures itself over time. Mm-hmm. Or it could just be that it's a slightly sticky surface, and for whatever reason there's dust here like everywhere.
And I do have a thing of paper and a pen that I can...
Okay, so you're going to try to transcribe them? Yeah. What languages do you know?
Common, Draconic, Druidic, and Elvish.
Okay. It does not look... Actually, it resembles Druidic, but in the same way you had seen the Druidic on... partially on the symbol itself, that had been a sort of a corrupted form of Druidic. This appears to be almost an ancient form of Druidic.
Okay.
So it's going to take a little time, and you'll transcribe it out.
Okay.
And I will make sure I find... Oh, what are you called? I knew how to do these things. I know how to internet.
Interwebs!
There we go. Okay. Are you just going to stay there, the two of you, at that point, or...?
I'm going to continue, like, doing... I'll do the scribing, and then I'll go to talk to Clark, because we need... Me and Clark need to talk.
You start to transcribe it a bit, and there, you kind of keep turning the thing around, and every time you think you've found it all, you realize you have to tilt it slightly, and there's another line there, and there's another line. Make a history check. With advantage, actually, because you're a druid.
17 plus 2, so 19.
19, okay. You almost fill a page, which seems surprising given how small the thing actually is. But you do, with the aid of the magnifying glass, kind of keep spinning this around. And you transcribe this ancient Druidic. And one of the weirdest things about Druidic is that it is so intertwined that it's not a left to right or right to left language. It's almost like you go halfway through this one, then you find the hook, and you find where that's hooked later on as it completes the idea, and that is then further elaborated by the stuff in the middle, and unfolds almost like a flower unfolds, where there's different stages of different things.
I've now, like, taped two pieces of paper together.
conspiracy wall up there. But as you look at it and figure this out, and it takes the better part of an hour, and you kind of, some of the symbols get a little hard to transcribe, and you kind of have to look at them twice, it describes a ritual. And it becomes clear, based on what Zacchaeus had mentioned, that this is its own ritual of creation. It's a little strange. To paraphrase the ritual, the idea is that you set up some ground. You do not clear the ground. It must have natural growth. Then you convince your enemy to enter the ground. And then you release the seed. And it kind of indicates to you that your enemy's destruction will be the creation of your ally.
Hmm. Interesting.
What are you laughing about?
It's like a little FU bomb.
Kind of, you know, there's a little bit of that. Which, thinking about it, it is in Druidic, it's an ancient Druidic. This is not really the way things are done these days. There's a much more, I mean, when you slay an enemy or are fighting, there's meant to be, you know, a death, there's meant to be a fight going on. But this is strange. This is creation through death.
Necromancy okay. Plus.
Literally no necromancy involved, but yeah, it's meant to be. Giant FU bomb's not a bad way to describe it in some ways. And it's a little bit weird. But you now have the knowledge of what to do.
Okay.
Do you describe this to the rest, or are you kind of keeping notes to yourself? How do you want to approach that?
This is weird. Hmm? This is very, very weird.
Good weird or bad weird?
Weird, weird.
Glad we got that cleared up.
The first thought that comes to mind is that this may be a solution to our wild hunt problem.
Excellent. How?
But also that she might know what this is. Because I don't know how old my mother is, let alone her older sister. This is an ancient druidic. It's a thing. It explains the ritual that you were talking about. And basically, it would need us to be someplace with natural growth. And we would have to, like, lure them into this place. And then release the seed. And then that would, what did you say, make?
The death of your enemy would be the creation of an ally.
Yeah. That.
Is there any natural growth in the shadow?
No.
Those are thorn berries. Were there berries?
I highly doubt that that is a natural occurrence. But also, the wild hunt isn't here right now.
Yes.
Please leave a message.
I'm sure we can leave a message somewhere, but I don't know. I don't think that's how this works.
I was thinking that perhaps if there's any natural growth in the shadow and the beholder is a thorn in our side, we could potentially trick
him. I'm not wasting this on a beholder.
No, understood. I just hope the wild hunt does not know what this is.
The one thing that becomes clear to both of you, however, is this is a seed. This does not have the properties of the seed that you think that Salthorg was looking for.
Mm-hmm. It's probably not what he was looking for. So at least there's that.
Yeah.
But we have a pillar. We have this solution to our wild hunt problem. We're getting somewhere, guys. Yeah. We're getting somewhere.
So with that moment of cheerfulness.
Cheerfulness and just pure anxiety.
And you can imagine that she's been kind of writing this madly out on the paper and occasionally having to correct yourself as some, you recognize some of the symbols aren't quite what you thought they were. And this small, it's hard to distinguish, does that have a curve with a hook or a curve with a straight thorn or a curve with whatever?
Druidic is supposed to be made with leaves and sticks, not written.
That's true. Although carved into a walnut does seem, you know, something that they would do.
Yeah.
In the meantime, Clark is just simply
hanging out.
Hanging out.
You can sharpen a weapon too much, so he stops before that.
That's true. Laying out the weapons before you see the sort of three weapons you now have as your primary ones, the sacks, and you think somewhat back to the victory which led you to the sacks. Mm-hmm. The smaller knife, the... What's it called? The knife?
The sacks, which is the small knife.
Oh, sorry, I get that.
Lucille. Mm-hmm.
Lucille, that's what I was trying to think of, yes.
And the magical glaive.
Right, and now the glaive.
Yeah.
And you still have these kind of ugly-looking jawbones attached to your hip. Mm. The flesh has not rotted. The flesh has kind of stayed there unless you clean them off.
I assume that he would have cleaned them at some point during the process and left them as bones.
So you specifically wanted just the bones?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yep, they're there and as fresh and kind of partially broken as they were when you took them.
Mm-hmm. He'll do some thinking.
Okay.
Otherwise, he'll just listen to the banter.
All right. Does Elzara want to go talk to Clark at this point? Or?
Yeah. Okay. Can I talk to you for a minute?
Sure.
You've been acting weird.
Gathers things. Move to another space.
Yeah.
Yes, I have.
What's up?
I need more specific questions. There's two.
Why are you acting weird?
give me an example.
You're using magic.
Yes. This weapon, it'll hold up the glaive, knows magic.
I see.
And it has shown me how to perform it through the wielding of the weapon.
I see. That's weird.
Yeah. It speaks to me.
Unsettling.
With many voices.
Not making that better.
And it's hungry.
Really not making that better.
Say it doesn't like Zacchaeus, then it'll make it better.
What else do you wish to know?
Something else. Just in general, we haven't caught up in a while about stuff.
Certainly. I've seen my sister in visions.
You have a sister?
I have a sister. She guided my hand against the large creature with the tentacles. That's how I was able to defeat it.
That was a thing that happened.
She speaks to me through a dream. Where I speak to her from this place.
I was going to think, no, that's not a druid spell. Never mind. Thinking of wrong character.
She is with my ancestors. Their ancestors, our people. And somehow she's able to speak with me here.
Interesting.
Briefly. And more than once.
Interesting.
I've also seen the columns. And he pauses, looking for understanding. In the land of the dead.
I see.
I've walked among them. And this is the first time. I've died many times. This is the first time I've seen the columns. And I've seen the dead that walk among them.
Interesting.
Some of them are... weak and pathetic and lost. Others are driven and wear red cloaks and masks with bright red smiles upon them. Have you heard of this?
Have I?
Actually, make a history check.
12.
Okay.
I asked about it earlier. Anything about
you can make a history check as well, as he mentions again. I'm assuming you're kind of not really whispering to each other.
Clark's
not. No, we wander around into a different area.
Oh, you did go somewhere else. Okay.
Yeah. 14.
14, okay. There's something, but you're not quite putting your finger on it. Same for both of you. This, the mask with a face on it, I don't know what that means. Red cloaks. You've seen a lot of people with red cloaks.
Follows of Arvax.
Red robes. Black mask with a smile. That was going to be before.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I don't know.
Okay.
It doesn't ring a bell. I mean, I'm the old... You might...
It's ringing bells, but you're not able to put a finger on it. The number of people and crazy things you're seeing over the last year.
I mean, like, Zacchaeus might know more. He's actually died.
Is it anything that happened in the last month?
No.
I remember hearing voices as I came to this place saying that we were supposed to right a wrong or change something.
Hmm.
It seems that we're purpose put here.
Yeah, definitely. I was there for that.
Make a religion check as that occurs to you. Mm-hmm.
That's a 2.
Okay. Nothing particularly resonates with that, that thought, but...
Because the dryads were saying that out loud.
That's what they were.
Yeah.
Okay. I forgot that
you weren't at the...
I only heard echoes of that talk before I found myself here with you.
Yeah, they were saying that out loud.
We will have to kill the giant eye at some point.
Probably.
And we will have to deal with the one at the skull at some point, I believe.
I don't know how Paturo's going to react to us.
I would like to meet him.
Me as well.
He's the father.
You're not here. Oh. We went into another.
they did go somewhere else.
Yeah. He's the father of my people. I should meet him before.
He owns part of my soul.
Do you fear the rest of it?
We kind of broke a deal with him.
That's not good.
No.
Perhaps you should discuss with him how to fix that.
The deal involved killing someone who saved my life multiple times.
I could vouch.
You may have met her in the mines up in Farhaven while you were up there with Umrun, Thyestra.
I think actually he's never been up there.
No, no. He stopped in Vator and I continued.
Oh, he stopped in Vator. Yeah. Oh,
sorry.
So, for some reason I thought he went up with him.
No, I think that was a possible idea, but yeah. I think in the end he just stayed in Vator to check out the underworld.
Yeah. I wouldn't have said that then, because
that's fine.
Mm-hmm. It's been a couple months.
Yeah.
He realized who you're talking to, and it's like, no, you've never been to Farhaven.
No. But yeah, no. One of the avatars of Paluxia.
Okay.
So yeah.
I understand that Paturo and Paluxia had a relationship at some point.
Yeah.
From the wall we saw earlier.
Yeah, I thought my family drama was dramatic.
I think whatever changed in him is the reason we're here, and that we should change it back.
It's a possibility. I mean, we do have this thing. The pillar in the bag of holding.
Oh, okay. So. The stretched bag of holding.
Of all of the bosses of this place, Paturo seems to be the only one to get us home. And if an agreement could be reached with him, perhaps it would change this place for the better as well.
Possibly. For some reason, I think that Versatra may have had something to do with what this place has become as well.
That's a name.
The Queen of the Wild Hunt.
Oh. They have a queen?
Yeah. Yeah, my mom's sister.
She doesn't live here.
She was here for a while. Mm. In that creepy forest.
Hates all the trees. Okay. Well, I don't know what else to tell you. If you have more questions, I'll answer them.
Just don't shut yourself into a corner on your own. We're a team. We're here for you.
I understand that.
Okay.
I did try to save the little one.
Yeah. I don't know how I feel about the little one. The one who's not, who's under, how tall is Clark?
Right. Like
5 foot.
Yeah, yeah. The littlest of us.
I still don't know how I feel about that. I also can't keep you guys alive. Please stop running into danger. I'm not Umrun.
I can't guarantee that.
I am not Umrun. I can't keep you guys alive. Especially not here.
I understand.
Like, do my best, but...
If I hear anything new, I will let you know.
Please do. To the weapon.
The weapon doesn't seem to acknowledge your presence.
I do it anyway.
Although the voices in your head do.
Yeah, they wish to see... they wish to dine on blood and death and possibly souls.
It comes across a little less violent than that. There is a sort of sense of, you know, we should probably consume her soul. It would be for the best. Mm. But there's also a... But I guess we won't.
It's eager to feast.
I see.
And it wishes that I live.
Well, that's good. Just... Please don't die in a bowl of darkness again.
I will try my best. If I do, take the box from my body. Give it to Amrun. It is important to me.
I'll make sure it happens.
Thank you. That's it.
All right. As you each find your own ways back, Orda will find a spot for each of you. Orda's come out to the front to check on Kazima. Is it quiet? Is there anything happening? And he kind of looks out through the hole.
Seems fine so far. He'd have set the dolls on guard for as long as they're going to be around. Be a few more hours.
Yeah. They're kind of, with the candle on top, almost piled on top of each other, staring out through the narrow hole where the stones leave. Oh, good. I'm glad. Won't be, well, I mean, he'll probably be back at some point. But I don't think he can get in.
Hopefully not today.
I think Martin and Agatha can help me move the stones, though. So I think I'm okay for a while.
Keep them as safe as you can.
Certainly. It'd be nice to have the company. How did you come to be here? You don't seem like all the others. Not the others that are with you, but...
It's all through a big hole.
Oh.
That's about as accurate as I can be. Some sort of portal.
So you're not dead? Oh.
Nope.
I wonder what that means.
So do we.
Oh. Well, maybe the morning will... morning. It's a habit. Maybe when we wake, we'll have some answers.
I let them think about that. I'm just here to make sure they get home.
Oh, and if you do happen to pick up more stray thornberries, maybe make sure that temple gets a few back. They can really use them.
Sure.
Good. Sleep well.
Pop another one.
At that point, make a constitution saving throw.
Oh, no.
Eight.
You're overbearing.
Like a light. They are dangerous to have in mass consumption.
Uh-huh.
Except when in a pie.
That's different. There's treatment there.
Exactly.
As you all find yourselves, are you staying... Orda would ask if you want to stay in separate rooms or if you want to stay in the same room. You get the weird sense, as Orda is talking about it, like there's no issue with having more rooms. And it's almost as though the temple itself will reconfigure.
Nice.
As needed.
I'm indifferent.
Indifferent as well.
Different rooms it is, then.
I would prefer to share a room with someone.
Well?
We can be roommates. Do you mind if I stop by the mural first?
If I'm allowed to sleep in silence, sure.
Well, of course. I work in a library. Silence is my favorite thing.
Thank you.
Orta says, do you want to look at it now, or do you want to wait until we've slept? I'm still kind of shaken a bit, so my mind isn't the clearest. Although I'm feeling better, that berry is amazing. And he finds the two of you a room. This room's as are before. They're very simple. There's not really any ornamentation whatsoever. Mm-hmm. Simple, squarish shapes and bedding. Finds you a room. It's about the same size as what theirs is, only it only has one bed. But everything else is simple.
Super single.
Essentially. I don't know if you want to wake at any particular time, but I can wake you if you feel like it, or whenever you come awake, I'll be awake.
I should be fine.
I should be fine as well.
As you wish. Sleep well, and for myself and for Ina, thank you. Thank you for standing up for us with those things. That's what we do. Sleep well. And with that, each of you have a good night's sleep. We will pick up after the break with what happens next. The morning, the after sleep. Gotta stop calling it morning. What you plan to do next. So, for those of you watching, we'll be returning hopefully with about 15 minutes. If you're watching this on the YouTube, it'll seem like it's no time at all. And here we are, back in the colorful flesh of humanity. Yay! I don't know why it came out that way. I'm thinking of some sort of, flesh-eating creatures, maybe. I don't know. Part 2 of Legends of the Drowned Isles, episode 29. Should probably have looked that up beforehand. A full night's rest happens.
Woo.
It's a little weird because there is no indication of day or night. It's weirder still because in the Temple of Namazani, although you've slept in them before, there's no indication of change whatsoever. Everything always seems pristine white and unchanging, like the nature of Namazani themselves, perhaps. But you all get a good rest. No dreams of darkness. No things changing or challenging you, and then you wake. Who wakes first?
I would do my 4 hours meditation, 4 hours awake, so
okay.
I'd be awake after 4 hours.
Are you going to get up and explore, or?
I would probably get up and go back to the main room and just chill, tend my weapons.
Make a wisdom saving throw.
Fourteen.
It's right over here. Maybe it's just over here, and then around the corner. And after a few minutes of kind of wandering a little bit, Orta walks up to you. Ah, you're awake. Good. Did you sleep well?
Yeah.
Good.
Yeah.
Was there some place in particular that you were at? Follow me.
Yeah.
And after he's kind of brought you back to the room, he goes off and proceeds to bring each of you there. The last one he brings, actually, is Guzaima.
I mean, I would be there for, 4 hours on my own.
So you're going to go there just as soon as you've awoken?
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
I'm already sitting in a room alone.
Okay.
And then you get to do it again.
Hooray! It's a bigger room.
It's a bigger room.
Yeah, it's different.
Did you bother taking down your alchemy stuff last night?
Or? I probably wouldn't have.
Okay. It's still there. Inert, because you probably would have at least made sure all of the things that normally mix together to make the things fancy and fancy alchemy things are done, but it's there.
I just tinker, not do anything in particular, just mess around with stuff.
Okay. Did Zacchaeus go straight to sleep, or did he stay up studying spells, or what?
He probably went straight to sleep, and spell prepping goes on in the morning, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, probably just went straight to sleep.
Okay.
After nearly dying several times.
A gentle rap on your door as you wake up.
Mm.
You hear Orta's voice. I don't know if you wanted to wake up now. Not sure how.
Sure.
Right,
the mural.
If you want. The others aren't all awake yet, so.
It'll kill some time until they wake up then.
As you wish.
And he leads you over to the main room where you are. Zachas was asking about the mural.
I would like to see it as well.
The rest won't be up for a while, but if you don't mind, we can do that now.
Open 4 hours. Yeah. Question to the DM.
Yeah.
Oh. Because I slept for 8 hours. I thought you meant it was like 8 hours after.
He apparently thought you were an elf. So you're a little groggy. Okay. If you'd rather wait.
I can wait 4 hours from now, or I can wait.
Sorry, I didn't realize.
No worries.
And I'll go back to bed. I don't sleep.
Can we treat this as, like, you know when you wake up in the middle of the night and you have no recollection of having woken up?
Kinda.
Okay, so that way I still get my full HP back.
You will still get,
you can do that with a 2-hour break in the middle.
Yeah, as long as you don't have rigorous activity.
Yeah.
You didn't go run a marathon.
Make a perception check.
That is 23.
Maybe it's just the general magical effect that happened to Zachas, because he got elongated through that weird magical effect in Taraka. But are his ears a little longer? And then Orta leads Zachas away to go rest for another 4 hours. I didn't realize, sorry.
It's okay. He'll be grumpy in the morning, but it's fine.
He's always grumpy in the morning.
He's just always grumpy.
So be it. Is there anything I can bring you?
Nah. I'm just gonna tinker a little bit. I don't know. Keep busy.
Okay. That's probably for the best. And he gives you that sort of genial pat on the shoulder, sort of like, there. That's probably for the best. Even though, you know, you haven't really suffered quite much in the last 24 hours, anyway. But you awake.
Mm.
The glaive is in your hand, and you can hear the knocking on the door.
Okay.
I don't know if you're meant to be awake yet. I think you're a half-orc. Normally have to sleep the whole time. I've made a mistake already, and I didn't
We're
know
in the same room, too, as soon as making a mistake again.
You've had a full night's rest at this particular point.
Okay, gotcha.
But he's sort of tentative, and you realize you're gripping the glaive pretty tightly. You don't remember picking it up. In fact, you're pretty sure you put it across the room last night.
I will arise now, thank you. Gathers things and be ready to go.
Yeah, same here. Were you just sleeping with the glaive? Isn't that dangerous?
For you?
Well, I'm glad we're not sharing a bed then. Jeez.
I don't know you that well.
But just try to be careful. Unless... There was a story my parents once told me when I was a child that if I put a book under my pillow and put my head on it over the pillow... then the knowledge would be easier to absorb. It's probably just the truth they used to shut me up, but what if there is truth to it? Do you perhaps gain increased combat abilities if you put it under your pillow? Or give it a big hug as you sleep?
I don't have an answer for that question.
It's more like thinking aloud. It was a theory anyway.
The weapon and I have an understanding. As best as I can understand it.
He's cheating on Lucille.
I hear from across the wall.
It's an open relationship.
Understood. Right, the mural.
If you'll follow me, I'll lead you back to the common room and then I'll go fetch your friend.
I'll pick up my stuff.
Okay, and he leads you back. It takes about 20 seconds to get back to the main room. It took longer to get here last night.
I've probably zoned out on burned water.
You burned water?
Yeah.
Okay.
Lost in my brain.
There's a sort of acrid smell across the room as the residue from water was boiling is sort of hissing on the bottom of a beaker. And you can see Elzara kind of staring at the wall a little bit.
Is it supposed to smell like that? It reminds me of Salazar's laboratory.
Druid craft, I'll fire off.
I suddenly create a little flower and it melts. moments later, Orta finds you at the front. You wake up with the three doll-like creatures kind of piled around you, no longer, I believe, themselves. Yeah. Nope. But they kind of went to sleep, and the last act was to curl up beside you, which feels quite warm, actually.
Well, technically it's two potion bottles and a candle.
Yeah. Weird, but sure.
I need to collect more dolls.
Your friends are awake and gathering.
Ah, good. When are we leaving?
I don't know. Some people wanted to take a look at our memory wall. I supposed you might want to be there, but I can leave you here if you like.
Are they in danger?
Well, I mean, unless learning the truth causes danger, I don't think so.
Nah. No harm.
I think the truth is good. I'll stay here on guard.
Okay. Do you need anything?
No, I should be fine. He'll sit against a wall and pop another berry.
Okay. With
then sit back with a peaceful look.
Sort of the strong aftertaste of the one the previous night before still on your lips, for where it kind of caused you to crash. It's easy to kind of let the world fade away for a moment. Everything becomes gray and indistinct.
Also, he has a body mass about like 10% of any of theirs, so it is really potent.
It's magic. Who knows how it's going to affect you. Order returns. Your friend has decided to stay up front. I think he wants to guard. He was the one that was shooting at the Southog before.
Yeah.
Yeah, that could have gone poorly. He really hates aberrations.
Oh, well. I pity him here, then. I think there were all aberrations of our own kind.
Suddenly, Kazama realizes that and vows to murder him.
And the game ends. No. Victory to Cobalt. If you'll follow me, I don't know if you've seen one of these before. They're as much meant to be interpreted as they are to literally depict what's going on. They're scenes taken out of the history that we have here, at least as far back as the temple goes. And oftentimes, it's not the first founders of a temple who create the first memories, more of the people who came after them that create the memories of the first temple. But I don't know all the stories, so this is going to be a little harder, and I'll have to interpret a bit more.
Not a problem.
And he leans you around the corner. Again, this hallway extends now in both directions where it didn't before. And you see, again, the relief carved out upon the rock. Now, I won't go through each of the panels like I did in the previous one. Some of them are similar, showing less detail about the aftermath of what happened, and less detail about the very beginning of what happened between Paturo, Paluxia, and the worlds. There is a little bit of that, but it's almost as though it's a minor element. Instead, this one seems to depict a massive forest. And there is, at one point, a center to the forest. What looks like a female figure standing there. I don't know its name, but the heart of the forest is the way it was described to me.
The heart?
The heart. And later on, there is a sign of something falling from the side. Not falling from above, but seeming to fall from the side and pierce the heart of the forest. And then the entire relief is inverted, where it was the solid surface is rising to depict all the things. It's almost as though now it's the curved-in surfaces, depicting the inverse of the forest as it was before. There is a circle of water that runs around the forest, and after the impact it breaks and splits in two, with some of it running off of the other side. Based on the map that was given to you by the other speaker, it would be easy to see this as festering. and as the river, the Greybrook, running around it, no longer in a circle, but now broken and split in two. It depicts, I'm sure I get my notes here. It depicts now the same forest, but there are humanoid shapes surrounding it. But they're all twisted and deformed in one way or another. And the forest seems thicker. And the heart of the forest seems to be obscured. Still barely a trace of an outline of a feminine figure, but now not only pierced and cut, but also obscured by overrunning branches. And in the last one of Festering, and again, these are probably 20 or 30 different panels, and there's panels on the other side depicting some of the people who've come here, and the high priests and the speakers that have been here before, but those become more or less names and dates, reminiscent of the begats in the Bible, where it's just like name after name after name, and this one trained this one, and this one left, and this one, and later on, there's like, well, this one ascended, and this one was killed, and this one left. They do not know what happened to that one. Those sorts of things happen, depicting, you know, legions of them, at least 100 to 200, and the difference in span of time becomes less and less distinct as you go along, until eventually it comes to Orda and Ina as the last one, and you can see that there's actually a truncation of Orda's line, essentially. But it ascends upward, and then there's dots carved in, freshly carved. The dust is still rough on the edges. Probably that's what Ina was doing last night. But on the other side, the depiction of Festering now, or whatever the forest was before, has completely obliterated and obscured the heart of the forest, no longer visible and distinct from everything else. But all the curving and twisting lines that are represented trees and vines and things now are jagged edges cutting through. And then on the edge of that, there's a depiction of dragons flying in. So we've seen the dragons. They've come since I've been here. None would venture into the Festering. But they seemed bold. And they were tearing in. And they were looking for something.
The heart?
Or the seed?
I don't know. I didn't know what Ina had told Zalthok. I don't know what kind of deal they might have struck. Ina would range across the land from time to time to find lost souls or people who had been just simply waylaid. Bring what we could back here to bring to safety. Much as we've done for you this evening, but she never mentioned Zalthog, not in that way. We knew of him. Powerful. Seemed to always know what was going on. People would whisper of him. You wouldn't see him directly. At least not more than once. But, the dragons came and stayed. I don't know where they came from. But they've been here long enough that they're part of the permanent fixture.
Hmm. And all of those are after, like, what we had seen.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. In fact, they're more detailed than the beginning part. And Ana would mention that this temple is newer than the one that was in Withergate.
Okay.
Withergate was one of the first temples.
Okay.
And this one was founded long after that. That's why there's only an abbreviation of what came before. And there's an indication that even that was long ago memory by the time they put it on the wall.
Yeah.
Presumably by the founders or some of the early founders who decided that was important to put on the wall.
Okay.
The object falling in this panel, the previous one, there's an object falling sideways and piercing the heart. What was that? Does anyone know?
Well, the stories are vague at best. More of an allegory, almost a poem at this point. But whatever it was an indication that
It came from the north, I think. What we call north. From the Ember Skull. From that direction. What exactly it was, we don't know.
Was Pichiro still or already living in the north at this point? Maybe he could have had something to do with it.
Maybe. But Turo ultimately has something to do with everything here.
According to Seldhog, not so much anymore.
Well, Seldhog is an opportunist. If he sees an opportunity to take power away from Paturo, I'm sure he would take it. He's never bothered us.
Until this seed. Has the priestess said anything about the seed being in this temple?
I didn't know anything about the seed. I don't think there's anything like that here. I haven't seen all the rooms, so I'm not sure, but I don't think so.
And how would you describe the heart of the forest? It's possibly still there, just very buried.
He reaches out and kind of runs his hands over the relief. I believe it's still there. She's still there. I don't have a real basis for that belief. It's just sort of something I know. But things don't leave, and things don't die here. They just change. Rarely for the better.
So was she some kind of entity?
I believe she is the forest. But I don't really know what that means.
I wonder if she could be restored somehow.
Oh, that would mean going into Festering. No one goes into Festering. It's dangerous. Even as close as it comes to us, I see it. Eager. I never walk close to it.
Yeah, I've seen what happened to the Sorrowsworn that ended up in it.
It is only by Namazani's will that this temple still stands. And that it is not overgrown already. I fear that it may someday.
The priestess, you said, would she venture into the Festering sometimes?
I can't imagine how she would.
Okay.
But I didn't know she knew about or was dealing with Salthok, so maybe. The only thing even remotely close to the Festering is the Grove.
The Grove?
Yeah, the Grove. It's where the Thornberries come from. Right. It's only been here for a while.
Not too long.
I've never been there myself. I grew up in Withergate. And I was lost. I had a lot of scars. Over time, after being taken in by Ina, they went away. I suppose that may mean that I get to ascend too.
It's a possibility.
Yeah.
It's hope. It's all that I have left.
Alara is fiddling with her ring.
How dangerous is it to go to the Grove? Could you take us there? Weren't we supposed to find somebody who tended to the Grove?
Yeah, Bernard Cotton.
Yeah. Do you know of him?
I know of him. Everybody knows of the gardener, but I've never met him. I haven't really gone in that direction.
Okay.
It wasn't really safe to travel very far on my own. I've stayed here mostly. I was supposed to go to Withergate to deliver a message. I only got about halfway there and I turned back. And when I did, well, I found those things outside the temple. Maybe I was supposed to be way longer. I mean, we do go to check the other temples from time to time. I hadn't done it. I assumed that I was just supposed to be my time to go. He looks uncertain and a little confused.
What was the message? In case we happened to be going that way.
It was that the dragons were hunting. That it was dangerous. But maybe it was something else.
Were you to deliver it to the temple?
Yes.
Okay. If we happen to go that way, I'll pass your message.
I'd appreciate that.
And we'll pass on the message that your priestess is gone as well. Messengers!
Mm-hmm. I don't know how... I don't know. Maybe this is a good thing. This place is not kind.
It doesn't seem to be.
Maybe I can hope for ascension too.
You'll manage to ascend, I mean, eventually.
Thank you.
Clark's gonna get up and start walking.
Where to?
Go to the front door. Meet our other compatriot.
Make a wisdom saving throw.
Sure. 8.
I thought you rolled a d12 for a moment there.
Might as well have.
And mm-hmm. You start heading off, and the hallway is long. And then there's a turn, and then another turn, and another turn. It seems to be taking a while.
That's all right.
I do have one more question.
Yes?
In your time here, have you encountered someone named Versatra Moonshadow?
Versatra Moonshadow? No, I don't think so.
She also goes by the name of the Queen of the Wild Hunt.
And that his eyes go wide. Oh. Oh, yes. I remember the Wild Hunt. And he points to the wall. And the point where everything is obscured. That's when they were here.
It's that when they got here. I point at the...
Time is not precise. By the time I started to learn the wall, that had already been here. And had been here for a long time. Mm-hmm. But it seems like Festering rejected them.
Interesting.
At least that's as far as I can tell.
So they didn't stay in Festering?
No. No, they... They roamed everywhere. I don't know if they really traveled in Withergate all that much. The defenders, the large golems that mm-hmm. Baturo sends out seem to push them back. But there were a lot of tales. People who went missing and later were seen in the Wild Hunt. I believe they gathered a lot of lost souls.
I wouldn't doubt it. Thank you.
Thank you.
What should we do next? You wanted to check on the thornberries.
I wanted to check on the thornberries.
Find Bernard if possible, and then... Do you think there's a chance we can get to the heart of the forest? It sounds very dangerous.
Especially carrying what we're carrying.
I'll go find your friend. And he just turns and walks down the hallway, disappears around the corner. Oh, was there somewhere in particular you were looking for? And you've been walking for several minutes at this point, and he catches up with the dice. Follow me.
I feel like we're like a bunch of like 2-year-olds, yeah. And he's just like, nope.
There's no object.
I'm going to give you this brace to put on you, and I have this nice little cute cord to tie to this wall. But he leads you back to the front. Back to the front. Seems to be saying that a lot today.
Thank you.
No worries. It's a difficult place to navigate sometimes.
Obviously.
Should we ask if we can store this here for a little while ago. Probably.
I'm assuming he wouldn't make a deal with Saltog.
Probably not.
Maybe he knows more about how to get in touch with Maturo.
Probably not.
Damn it. Well, I'll ask anyway, just because. Why not?
Ironbound. What are they up to?
I'm just sitting watching the front entrance.
Okay.
Making sure it doesn't come back and use its vision to let stuff in.
Oh, okay. Well, we're getting ready to go soon.
Ah, cool. I'm packed.
All right.
Oh, wait. No, I'm packed.
About how long?
Soon.
Okay. Then I'm going to cast Tiny Servant again.
Okay.
I will have 3 Tiny Servants.
And are they the 2 bottles again? And the
2 bottles and a candle, because I'm all out of dolls.
Okay.
Clark will pass the time with some small talk while we wait for the others to show up.
Okay.
Yeah, we're just going to ask if we can...
You still want to die?
We can talk about that later.
As you wish.
We do have something else that we would like to ask of you.
Oh, that reminds me. I've got something for you, too. I'll just be a second. And he kind of disappears off into the vast maze, but is back in a few seconds. And he hands you a small, basically a box made out of stone. It's remarkably square, and the stone is white, much like the walls are here.
Mm-hmm.
This may help you. I had to do some carving last night, which means it frees up some of Demosthenes' essence, essentially. This whole building is really constructed of them. So, that essence is precious, and what can be useful if you know certain things to do. I saw your set earlier, so I know that you know some things can be prepared. Well, I made these for you. And inside the box, there are 3 oblong pills. They're about the size of horse pills. And 2 round white pills, which are a little shiny. These ones, the oblong ones.
3 of those?
Yes. They are the stone vigor of Nemazini. And when consumed, they will fill you with strength. These round ones.
2 of those?
2 of those. These ones are Stone's Patience of Demosthenes. And they will help to protect your mind. And in game terms, I don't have separate handouts for those, but those are what they do.
Cool.
Hopefully I haven't written a typo in there, but I think that's right.
Demosthenes Stone's Vigor, I have 3.
It's part of the magic.
Yeah, yeah. Suddenly it doesn't work like that, because Mark has to retcon something.
There's 2 white ones?
They're all white.
Okay.
3 were oblong, and the other 2 were round. I hope they can aid you on your trip.
Definitely.
I have a feeling I know where you're going, and you're going to need help. I wish I could offer more.
What we've offered is a lot already. We do carry precious cargo at the moment.
Oh?
That we were wondering if we could leave here while we go find Bernard.
Certainly. Is it dangerous?
Not at the moment. I'll glance at the bag. It's not getting any more unstable, is it?
You can see around the whites around the seams, and the seams probably seem a little stretched out compared to where they were, but maybe that's the same.
We should be fine.
We have a pillar.
A what?
One of the bones of Paluxia.
And his eyes go wide. You have a what? You actually have one?
Yes.
Can I see it?
And he looks excited, almost like a child.
At the moment, we had to...
I pull out the bag that's, like, out from under my skirts.
It's in there, and if we take it out, we probably won't be able to put it back in.
That doesn't look healthy.
No.
Probably not.
I probably owe her a new bag.
You do owe me a new bag.
And as you kind of bring it out and look at it, and he's kind of looking it over, both of you make, let me see, let's call it a perception check. Let's call it a straight up perception.
18, wow.
Okay.
I rolled low.
You pull the bag out, and the first thing you notice is the leather straps that are holding on onto the bag. They look worn. Mm-hmm. And as you look at the bag itself, you can see the surface of it looks stretched and thin, and most of all, aged. Well, I mean, I don't see why that would be a problem. I can't do much to protect it, but this place will.
That's all we ask. And nobody else is going to know in here except for us and our colleagues.
Sure.
So as far as we're aware...
Travelers may come and stay, but I will make sure they do not see this.
Nobody knows that we have it.
Because apparently people kill for these.
Sawthug would.
Yeah. We currently only have my bag of holding in our possession, correct?
Yeah, I think that's what we established.
Yeah.
Okay. That's why you had to take everything out of it
to
put this in.
Because this is starting to freak me out a little bit.
Yes.
Is it dangerous? I guess I asked that before, but...
It's more the bag is unstable.
It seems to be wearing down quicker than it would otherwise.
Well, of course it is. I mean, it's magical, but it's made of leather.
Why does everything wear down so quickly except hair?
Time wears all things. And this place... In this place, time moves strangely. Most things wear down. But the strange thing about hair is it grows back. And since we don't age, we have more time than we need for hair to grow back. So it's become pretty common to use it as a way to repair just about everything. Mm-hmm. And he kind of holds up his robes, and you can see the interior of his robes are latticework of hair that's been woven over time.
It looks itchy. It does a job.
It's surprisingly warm.
I will cast Mending on the bag.
Okay.
Again, to see if that does anything.
The straps seem to solidify and become fresh once again. The bag itself, nothing happens on the actual seams of the bag, which are still stretched out, but the surface seems less pitted.
Yeah. Hopefully that holds.
Mm-hmm.
That is my one worry.
I don't know if it's possible, but if something is going wrong, can I take it out?
Should we take it out while we're gone and then try to put it back in the bag?
Probably not.
That might stress the bag, mm-hmm. but we don't know what'll happen if the bag goes.
Well, if we're only going to the Grove, we are going to the Grove, right? Question to player?
At the moment.
Okay.
But, like... The amount of... The only thing that can hide this bag is me being in my wild shape.
Mm.
Because... And if you guys are in wind form or trying to hide it under clothes and stuff, hasn't worked.
No.
It literally becomes part of me. So...
If we take it out and then we can't put it back in, or if the bag ruptures as we try to put it back in, we'd be screwed.
Yes, but if it implodes and we don't have it, then we're screwed.
What do we do? How far is the Grove?
Less than half a day's walk.
As you measure days.
As GM curses himself for creating a timeless realm. It's the equivalent of that, though. And he would still remember what he feels like after half a day's walk, but it's a very inaccurate measure.
Okay.
Yeah.
could I quickly calculate, like, based on how quickly the bag has been decaying, if mm-hmm. we'd have time to make it there and back? Ample time.
Make a science roll? We don't really have science.
Arcana?
Arcana would work, yeah. Yeah.
It's the new science.
Oh, I got a one. So that's a 15 total.
It should last years.
It should last years.
I don't buy that. Like, it's gotten worse over, like, it's been, like...
A few days.
A couple days, yeah. Like,
I mean, a few sleeps, really. It's the only measure you have.
Yeah, it's been a couple sleeps.
Well, if you leave it here, hmm. as long as I have permission, and if I see it's going badly, I can take it out.
Yeah.
It would at least not be worse if I did that?
Probably not.
I suppose.
It is very large and very heavy.
Mm-hmm. Well, I won't try to move it.
Yeah.
I may be able to ask Namazni for some help there, but for the most part, I wouldn't move it.
Yeah. If you see that this bag is starting to get worse...
Yes. I suppose that's agreeable.
Yeah.
And then we can figure out a different way to carry it, I suppose.
Yeah.
Well, I will keep it, if you wish.
Thank you.
It would be a great help, because then we won't be trying to hide that while we travel.
It seems to attract things.
I'm sure it would. And he kind of, you know, is staring a little bit at the wispy white edge around the bag, because the energy is sort of seeping outward a little bit. Well, if you'll hand it, I'll...
I'll do it.
Okay. I'll be right back. And he goes and disappears into the vast maze of Namazni's temple. A few seconds later, he comes back.
That'll be of great help to us.
Mm-hmm.
No problem.
We will... If we're not back after a week's worth of sleeps, so 7 sleeps, then do with that. That's a reasonable time.
I suppose.
Give us 2 weeks.
I will not rush to do anything with it.
Yeah. If a long period of time goes by and we are not back.
All right. I can do that.
Thank you.
But.
That's when less target on our backs.
Give us like a month.
Hopefully, getting to the grove and back should be fairly simple and straightforward and free of attacks. Are we ready to depart?
I am.
I'll lead you to the front then. And he leads you up where the other two are standing there.
We would have had time to practice a few things, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm. So what are you practicing? Shell game?
Yeah. A little bit of pickpocketing. How to arrange yourself in a crowd.
Okay.
That sort of
strategy and tactics.
Yeah.
Okay.
Stuff that you can mostly think about, and the small physical actions that you can do, because the bigger stuff, we don't have the training space or the people for that, but...
Trying to pickpocket Elzera, you'll always fail.
Sure. All right, so you start doing a little bit of strategy moves. And
Andrea, thank you. You might be able to. Might.
We'll have to do our own battle royale, which is just a pickpocketing.
Pass, hard pass.
Well, after you've been kind of... sparring a little bit as well, probably as well, to figure out the feinting and different kinds of maneuvers. Order comes around the corner with the two of them in tow. Just a minute, I'll go fetch Martin and Agatha. They'd like to say goodbye, I'm sure.
Probably.
They're still sleeping.
They'll be back, hopefully.
And he disappears, and a few seconds later, a very tired-looking Martin and a not-quite-so-tired-looking Agatha. In fact, all of you make insight checks.
Nat 20.
Non-nat 20.
18.
Nice.
21.
Of course, wow. This is the insight tech.
Suddenly it's all the insightful. She has a sort of glow about her. And her hair is kind of messed up, and her clothes are kind of rapidly put on. And Martin, while he's acting grumpy, there's a sort of sly grin on his face from time to time. You have a feeling they took a full advantage of a peaceful night's rest,
right.
with each other.
What rest?
Hey, good job.
But they come around the corner, and Agatha, already smiling a bit, comes and says, "I could not thank you enough for saving us the first time, and for helping us that last night. I could not thank you even more. But if what Orda and Martin have suggested, you've got a lot more planned."
Yeah.
Oh, yes. Hopefully it all goes well.
Well,
than last night.
I wish you the best, and I wish we could do more, but... And she kind of glances over her shoulder at Martin. "I think we're going to stay here for a while."
Well, we will be back.
Good.
Mm-hmm.
So we hope to see you then.
We fully plan on being back anyway.
Good. And she goes forward and embraces Elzara. Is over, and Martin kind of gives you a firm handshake. He's surprisingly stronger than he looks. He looks fairly thin and lithe. But he's kind of one of those deceptive farmer people where, you know, they always look really skinny and then they have arms like steel.
Yeah.
And you realize him and Agatha have been pushing the cart all this time. They're actually in fairly good shape. Agatha comes over and gives you a strong hug. Agatha kind of looks at you and just sort of nods.
A professional nod.
And there's a glance kind of over the shoulder at the weapon as well, the glaive, as a nervousness, but she does seem to have the respect at least for you. And she watched while things were going on and saw the weird thing that happened to you, or at least part of it. Agatha kind of bends down to Kuzumaya. And for you, you'd better keep yourself safe.
I will.
And she kind of embraces you, kind of swallowing you in a hug, if you allow it.
Sure.
And she's very, very warm as well, which is strange to your physiology, how warm she is. Warm and soft. And she kind of steps back and kind of scratches at the corner of her eye a little bit, trying to hide a small tear. Good luck. And Orda clears his throat. Or a little more formally, may Namazani aid you on your journeys. And he casts aid.
Bless!
Is it plus 10?
Different thing. Plus 10 to your max HP.
It depends on the level.
It depends on his level, actually.
Yeah.
Oh.
And that's not right.
I think it's 5 times spell level he uses.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, typing hard. All right. Yes. So, he will cast this on can only choose 3 of you. So he cast it on Elzara, Kuzumaya, and Zakus. You each gain 10 to your current, to your hit point maximum and your current hit points.
He could cast it twice. That's what the last guy did.
This guy can't. Okay. That guy could. Ina's not quite that high level. Or Orda's not quite that high level.
Should Clark have these instead? He seems to be in.
I'll be fine.
Okay.
I have a sense your friend is resilient.
That he is. But he's also more in the thick of the melee, whereas I...
Already almost died once.
You have a point.
I'll be more careful next time. I was trying to hurry.
Well then.
Thank you so much.
And he turns to you.
No need. Thank you. You've done enough.
If you insist.
I do. You gave us shelter and rest. It's worth my thanks.
Well, let my personal blessing go with you then.
Fair enough.
If you do need anything, feel free to return.
Same.
We definitely will be back.
Mm-hmm.
I would like to hear of the Grove. Maybe if it's... If it's safe, I'd like to see it myself. I can't really leave this place, but maybe just for a little while. Martin grabs onto one of the sides of the stone, and Order grabs the other side, and Martin, surprisingly strong, is able to help him pull one side of the stones out. You can see the barrier there. It's not super visible, but there's a noticeable effect.
Before we go out, do we want to just walk for now so I have my sixth level spell?
Yeah, walking's all right.
Walking's fine.
Cool.
All right.
Clark would like to look at the spot where he dropped for a few moments before they move on.
Okay. As you move outside, you can see that there is no evidence of the remains of the Sorrowsworn. There's evidence of the battle, evidence of the ground being turned up and torn over, but even that seems to be fading fairly quickly. You look upon the spot where you fell, and there's a small amount of faded blood still there.
Okay. He'll reach down, grab a pinch of the earth, give it a sniff, and then drop it.
Okay.
As we're exiting,
mm-hmm.
Kujaima will look at the dwarf and the human, and sort of, is it possible for people to get pregnant down here?
Who are you asking?
The priesty guy.
The
one who's closer to my size.
Right.
And I don't say it that quietly.
Okay.
And Elzer is just like...
He's stunned for a moment and then kind of looks over. Oh, no child has ever been born to the Shadow.
Interesting. Good luck, you two.
I won't leave. And there's a sort of little bit of reddening of the cheeks from Agatha, and Martin just sort of looks away.
I'll look at them and say, like, sorry.
You and people in your hangouts.
You head outside. Clarg does this ritual with the sand, which is strange, but you can hear the rustling of festering.
I need to change my spells.
Only about 25 feet away at this point, and you can see the movement of these twisting vines wrapping around trees, massive thorns on each of them, and it almost seems to writhe and twist. You walk. You know the direction. There's a slight embankment as you come back up to where the rough road-like space is, and you turn southward. It seems as though some of the thick cloud-like air that was there the previous day has thinned somewhat, and you find yourselves able to see a little bit further and see a little bit higher. As you move and you kind of crest a bit of a hill, you can see far off to your left this twisting, winding, white, ghost-like spire, referred to as the Umbral Nest a couple of times. Mm-hmm. Along your right-hand side, you can hear some of the rushing water of the Grey Brook, which is split in two and coming around this side. And you see festering, covering over the river, strangely able to somehow cross the river, as forests are not usually able to do. And below you, as you move down, you can see festering growing out and, in fact, intersecting and crossing over the river. There would have been one thing that Martin would have told you before you left. And he would say that to find the grove, you have to look for the three stones. Two of a shorter height, just about as tall as a person, as a man, and the other one standing twice as long. That will be your guide mark. That's where we saw before. We did not enter the grove. It came to us.
Kurt?
You start walking along. An unknown amount of time later, it feels like it may have been half an hour or an hour or 2 hours. There's a little bit of stiffness in your legs when you first started walking that went away and now starts to return as that first burst of stretching has come through. Festering seems to have been growing thicker along the side. And you can see now that it very quickly rises up into the sky. In fact, where clouds would be nothing but festering, reaching the very top, now where you know the top of this enormous cavern to be. Winds a little bit, but continually pushing inward to the point where the road that you're on is itself covered by festering, and you have to move inward even more. you come to a small rise in a hill, and below you, you can see the three stones that Martin talked about, themselves shrouded by festering. It has grown out to almost engulf them entirely. You can see only small amounts of the stone still peeking above, festering. But now you see it below you. Where the grove is supposed to be is in the middle of festering at the moment.
That's not good. I'm assuming it wasn't like this before.
From what they said, they could get to those stones at least.
Yeah. So, what's the plan, guys?
I turn into a fire elemental.
Okay. So in response to the question, whoosh, suddenly the blazing pillar of familiar flame is standing there.
Solid plan.
Larg will arm himself and follow the fire.
Okay. Fire elemental goes and kicks a tree.
Okay, so you're going to enter festering?
I'm going to stand at the edge and kick it.
Okay.
See what happens.
Basically, the equivalent of like is kicking like something to make sure that it's,
you know, like a hornet's nest, for instance.
Yeah.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
Solid plan. I like
it. I use fire, I burn.
Mm. Okay.
Elzara is slightly emotional.
So as you take a swipe towards the edge of festering, and then probably having been closer now than ever before, a little bold, emboldened probably by your fiery form, you move up to it, and you can see this thick, twisting mass of vines. And you take a swing towards it, and it hisses when the fire hits it. But it reacts. Make a dexterity saving throw.
And we can't pull you out because you're fire.
It's fine. 15?
15? Okay. Yes. All of you watch as the fury form of Elzara walks up to the wall and begins to kick it. In mid-flight, you do get to roll your damage. In mid-flight, as her flaming foot comes in contact with the vines, the entirety of the wall reaches out and grabs onto her.
8 fire damage, okay. And it takes a D10 fire until it, at the start of each turn, because I'm guessing that it is flammable.
So it's 18 fire?
8.
8 fire, okay.
I rolled shit.
Alright.
But if it catches on fire, which it should.
Theoretically,
it does take a D10 damage at the beginning of every turn.
Okay. You take 23 points of piercing damage, magical piercing damage,
okay.
As the vines come to try to wrap around you. Being non-substantial, the vines actually clatter together and then retreat back in. They're on fire, but they basically raked through you. And you see the fire kind of burn on the edge, and then that edge gets pushed away and falls off, burning separately, leaving the wall separate.
Okay.
It seems to know how to treat fire and keep it from burning the rest of it. And definitely reacted.
Okay. Is it 20 or 21?
23,
actually. 23? I say, ouch.
I understand.
As you kind of see this thing kind of, what for a normal person would be basically slicing it on through, it just kind of, you know, pulls right through her form, with the flaming branches kind of falling off on their own, separated.
So we're clearly not going in there.
You're going to help her?
Make a perception check.
Well, because I think, like, didn't he say that it went through her, but it didn't, like, grab onto her?
It can't.
No.
You know that nothing can grab onto me when I'm...
Yeah.
You shoot things with fire, though. You could help.
What was it, a perception?
Yes.
Dirty 20.
As you're kind of looking away and the branches are falling back, you actually catch sight of an eye, a green eye that moves inside.
There's a green eye in there.
Do I see it?
No. She was up front, actually staring at the wall. Make a nature check now that you've actually seen it.
Nature is an 18.
18? Judging from the size and the way it was able to move through Festering, there's only one creature you know of that can do that. A dryad.
Dryad? Maybe?
Clark will approach.
Okay. How are you approaching?
Carefully.
I go like this.
I'll approach carefully. Hand of fire in your face. As Mother Hen decides that you're not going to, and attaches a little thing to your back. It's going to a clothesline. No, there's a clothesline of a different kind in your face.
Mm-hmm. So I would have heard her say dryad, maybe.
You understand primordial?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So I'll answer back in primordial.
I understand Calvin.
Oh, right.
It's hard for humans to say primordial. It comes out as crackling fire, so in this case. But
tell it to come out. Tell it we're friends.
It ran away.
Yes, I suppose like hitting it with fire is not a good idea.
Do you have any fire spells?
I got the usual firebolt. It might take a while to clear this forest with it.
Acid.
Clark, we're going to try to attack the forest.
All right.
He's going to concentrate very carefully and have the glaive change its form.
Okay.
And then strike at it.
So the scythe forming?
It turns into a giant scythe.
Okay.
The intent is to swing and then use a bonus action to disengage.
Okay.
So jump in, ka-chow, and jump out again.
All of you notice not only does the scythe extend, but it seems to elongate. And your reach is now 15 feet.
Keep that in mind for later.
There's an encouraging kind of shout from the chorus.
That's what I figured.
Yeah!
Ooh,
take
a swing. You got this, bro.
All right, take a swing.
All right. Natural 20.
Oh, wow.
So, 2d10. And I get an extra one because of orc stuff. 13,
19. How deep into the forest are the rocks?
Probably about 100 feet at this point.
Okay.
19. Maybe a little closer if you were on the other side. It looks like it's kind of like flowed over around them.
Okay. 25, with 6 of that being necrotic.
Okay. Yes.
And then disengage.
And then disengage. As you see Clark kind of reach forward and kind of turn the glaive slightly, almost like he was cutting down sheaves of grain, and it cuts deeply this semicircle into the edge of it. You do see it react as vines kind of fly outwards. A lot of them flying off now, they're disconnected, but vines kind of flying outward to try to catch you, but you've kind of leapt back a little bit, and they miss. Okay. What are the rest of you trying to do? It seemed to be successful, but it's going to be slow doing that way.
Yeah.
Can you get the dryad back?
Probably not. It ran into
it. It ran and hid, you presume? Based on your role as well, you're kind of thinking about it, and can you get the dryad back, and these questions is, why is a dryad here, for one thing? Because dryads are protectors of forests. And why is it protecting this one? Or is it protecting this one?
Oh, yeah, why are you here? But
in primordial, unfortunately, won't translate that well.
Yeah.
But you hear the fire kind of roar up at something.
Is there anything that's made visible when the section of the foliage gets removed?
It reveals some of the ground.
Okay.
Essentially, and you see the little stumps of the growth, they kind of wither down a little bit into the ground.
it's cleared a good, 10-foot chunk.
And it's not growing back so quickly.
It does not appear to be.
Okay. I'll just yell out, based on the information that I got from the Primordial and from Elzera, to the Dryad, who is hopefully listening, "Hey, come out! Can you let us in? We'll stop burning your forest!"
So, are you trying to intimidate or persuade? Is that a threat or a promise?
It would be a promise, but in Zagus fashion.
Okay, that's a persuasion check.
That's a zero level convincing.
So that's a 7.
Okay.
Please?
There is a response. What is your AC?
My AC is 11 right now, so it's probably like an insta hit.
Yeah, that's a 20 total.
That's a what? Did you say it was a 20?
20 total. Not an actual 20, though. However, as several of the thorns, as the wall kind of swooshes and moves and then flicks out, as several thorns go flying off in your direction.
Oh.
Three of them hit for 14 points of piercing damage. Make a constitution saving throw against poison if you have anything.
A 5.
Okay. You are poisoned as the needles jam into you and give away their little bit of poison. And you feel quite sickly as well to your stomach just from that. And it feels almost as though you're hungry.
Okay. Well, I'm not eating anything from that forest, that's for sure. You said 14 points?
Sorry, what?
You said 14 points of damage?
Yes. I thought you said 40. I was like, I don't think I said 40. Did I say 40? Alright.
Any ideas?
I walk over to the edge of the forest, the part that near where it's burning, but not where it's burning.
Okay.
And I'm going to cast Detect Thoughts and see if I sense any mines within 30 feet.
That's a cool use of that. Okay. Is there...
There's no save for detecting if there's mines. There's no save actually for sensing the thoughts. It's only if I try to go deeper that they get a save to push me out.
Okay. And range is...
30 feet.
That's weird.
Well, range is detect. Range is self, but I can sense mines within 30
feet. Right, okay. That's a weird way to do range, but yeah. You catch fleeting thoughts. You suspect that the sheer thickness of the vegetation here is actually giving it a bit of cover, strangely enough, from this. But you detect fleeting thoughts. The thoughts are mostly almost direct emotions. Fear, confusion, curiousness, worry, the sort of fight or flight instinct is kicking in. And most of all, overriding all of that is this underlying feeling of feeling of must protect.
He's being in comments. The Dryad that you thought might be here is scared and feels like they must protect this. You might get further if you try talking.
Well, I tried that. I just got needled by a bunch of needles.
You might get better. It might work better if someone else talks and you guys don't try burning down their stuff. But that's just a thought.
I'll back up and sit down and go like this.
Which is weird for a fire elemental to do. It just doesn't technically have
become
legs.
Become a bonfire?
Can anybody ask politely?
Literally stewing and,
I thought it was clear enough. Maybe it doesn't understand common that well.
I'll try, saying, hello. Hello?
I'll move 60 feet away.
Common... And deep speech and undercommon.
Are you maintaining the detect thoughts?
Yes.
Okay. The balance of the different thoughts reduces from fear, there's still some there, to more curiosity. And make a perception check.
Mm. 22.
You see movement in the trees and the vines in front of you. You don't hear anything. It's silent and it's almost invisible, but you sense the thoughts getting closer. Until eye level with you, you see what looks like a small green child.
Hello.
And the branches and trees around you kind of shift and switch and sway. And hello? Quiet, very childlike, coming back at you. Almost the same voice that you used.
Hello.
How old are you?
And that's you rude. Sense you sense confusion and
only to you
a misunderstanding.
You can't understand me.
You sense confusion from the entity. As if not understanding the question.
Are you an adult?
A little less confusion. I am grown. Are you?
Yes, this is as big as I get.
There's a sense of glancing away from you, probably glancing towards the rest of them.
Pouting fire.
With the again, with the connection you have in your mind, sensing the surface thoughts of fear when glancing towards her, of confusion when glancing towards Zacchaeus. And then there's a sense that holds on him. Are you here to take the gardener? In a very concerned voice.
We're here to see the gardener, not take him.
No, only really Kuzumaya hears this small voice in front of him.
We are here to...
Do I see the lips?
Sure. Yeah, with your perception, you can probably see the lips. Speaking common, but reflecting really Kuzumaya's own speech pattern.
We are here to find him, help him if he's in danger, possibly rescue him. I don't know what their plan really is.
There's a sense of confusion. You want to take the gardener?
If he wishes to leave.
You sense a second source of thoughts. Further down, almost at the limit of what you can detect. This one, very different in tone, has a much more stern tone of mind, almost as though no fear has been replaced with anger, annoyance, distrust. And then a third form, this time at the opposite end. This one almost entirely curiosity, whimsy, indifference in a non-frightened way to your presence.
There are others here. Others of you.
We three guard the grove.
Ah. You are part of Festering?
We guard the grove.
You're not part of Festering.
And there's confusion from her mind.
I turn back into myself. I'm like...
From the edge of the forest and the two distances where you had detected the others, you all see two childlike figures step forward. Dryads, as you had thought of them before. Green, green skin. But their bodies are covered with thorns that seem to come right out of them. Their hair is composed of vines that seem to move on their own. Small flowers are adorning their hair. Flowers which you guys actually recognize. They surrounded the trap. And they step forward.
Do I see that?
The one further to the left is a slight bit taller. Seems thicker. Its skin almost seems more like wood. The one on the other side, its skin seems more like flower petals. And it seems thinner and lighter, but moves more lightly as well. The one in front of you stays where it is.
Hello.
Actually, Lazara wouldn't have, if she's in the process of seeing that, she wouldn't have changed.
Okay. You still remain flame. The one on the far left is keeping an eye on you. That's the woody one. The one on the other side is just sort of cocking its head and looking curiously at you for the most part.
I'll say hello to the curious one.
And it kind of walks over to you. Keeps about 5 feet distance.
Starts to walk
around you to see you all.
You're not going to shoot me again, are you?
Those are pretty flowers.
Clark lowers his weapon.
Who notices that they're the same flowers as around the trap?
You do.
I do?
Yeah.
They're the same flowers that were around that trap.
Oh. Yes, they are. I was a little busy trying not to fall in.
Do you like my flowers? She extends a hand and a vine kind of carries a flower up to the end of it.
They look pretty. I've just seen them before.
Hmm. And she kind of breaks it off and hands it to you.
I'll hesitantly take it.
Okay.
Thank you. I hope it didn't hurt when you plucked it out with your finger.
She grows another one.
Nice.
I am Dwight. I am Floris.
Nice to meet you, Floris. I am Zachis.
What are you?
I am a half-elf.
Oh. And she kind of moves closer to you and strangely seems to stand up taller. But you can see that it's the vines around her feet have just sort of planted themselves, and she's just being carried up lightly upon them. Okay. And now she stands height to height with you, which is actually about almost 7 feet for you.
I'm a little taller than most half-elves. There was a thing that happened in an area. There was wild magic. Things went almost completely south, but long story short, I got much taller.
Why did you want to kill us?
We didn't. We didn't know.
That one does, and points directly at the ball of fire, the smoldering ball of fire.
They attacked you without thinking.
A misunderstanding. Burning me up a little stick right now. We sought to enter the grove. We were looking for Bernard, the halfling, the gardener, as you may call him.
She smiles and kind of leans back a bit, kind of floating upon the vines. Bernard is good.
Yes, that's what we heard. We hear he grows thornberries. Anyway,
The grove grows thorn berries.
Yes, my apologies.
The one in front of you, Kuzumaya, kind of whispers, but why do you have the reaper with you if you don't want to take Bernard?
The reaper?
Take the gardener, I should say.
Who is the reaper?
Oh!
And the branches around the wall kind of all shrink down like a finger and point directly at Clark.
Hmm.
We can't trust them, says the one at the very end.
Do you mean him? Or that?
Yes.
Hmm. They call you the Reaper.
What? Really? I want that soundbite.
They seem to be scared of you. Well, and of you, but that is more natural.
That weapon looks a bit scary, but...
Tell them I'll keep my distance if I need to.
And Floris moves back away from you and kind of floats upon these vines, heading in your direction, actually. Mm. And once again, the vines seem to root, and she grows taller this time to look down upon you. And you can see multiple vines are now growing out, building practically a bush underneath where she's standing. With more of these little small flowers. Little small blue flowers.
From the information that we know, mm-hmm. is Festering the grove, or is the grove in Festering?
From what you know, Festering is the island,
yeah.
and the overgrowth that it has. The grove was never mentioned as part of Festering, and if anything, it was the opposite.
Okay.
But something has happened.
Okay. Mm.
Clark won't disarm himself, but he's lowered his weapon.
Okay.
He says that, well, I'm assuming you can hear what he said. He's speaking the same language. He will not harm you unless provoked.
Why are you here? Says the forceful one at the other end.
We were looking for the gardener. We want to ensure his safety. We didn't know...
The one in front of you answers, the gardener is safe. We are here.
Okay. Can we talk to him?
She knows the gardener.
And all three of them kind of turn towards the ball of fire.
She is a elf under that.
She's a druid.
The one hovering over you, Floris, as she gave her name before, kind of moves over towards the fire.
I wave. Keep away. Just keep myself away.
Just a small static illusion of what she normally looks like.
Okay. The three of them look at the illusion. And you get the sensor looking between the illusion and the wall of fire.
Mm-hmm. The illusion's much smaller than
trying to imagine the the difference. How do you know the gardener? Says again the forceful woody one.
He was apprenticed to someone who taught me.
Make a persuasion check.
Hey, do the dryads speak elemental?
Do they understand me?
Yeah.
They seem to respect the thought.
Three.
Three? Okay.
It's like, I will burn you.
Language barrier.
The one near you, Floris, now has kind of approached you. And what did you learn?
I learned how to garden underground, thanks to some of his inventions. I learned that they started growing thorn berries in their gardens because of his work, and I wanted to meet him.
And the one named Floris kind of looks to the other two. I believe her. The one in front of you says, I'm not sure. And the woody one says, I don't care.
Everything that we've been indicated says that the woods themselves are bad.
Because the initial attacks were just one big misunderstanding, really, and we apologize for that.
I'm going to cast plant glows and regrow the
11
area.
Okay.
Except for a path in, because plant glows makes things really hard to get through. So yeah, their plants get very healthy for about 150 foot range.
Okay. There's a surprise.
That takes 24 hours to do that way.
Nope, it's one action, 150 foot range. All normal plants within 100 radius of the target become thick and overgrown. You can exclude one or more areas from the size being affected. If you want to make it enrich the yields for half a year,
A year, just the way you said it, you make them overgrown, you don't make them healthy.
Mm-hmm. Well, I make them grow a lot.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know the spell very well. I used it a lot.
Strange in a way because the growth is so thick to begin with, but there's a delighted squeal, both a verbal squeal and a mental squeal from the dryad in front of you as things start to reform. Large spikes start to form. Actually, make a nature check as you cast that.
19.
The new growth that you introduce is green and vibrant, and the leaves are strong and bright. But as it grows out, they become dark and overgrown and blacken, not into a sickly state, more into an aged state almost instantly. But it becomes solid and almost wood-like. The one named Floris pulls back. I am convinced. The one in the middle is kind of apoplectic for a moment.
My apologies for the damage we caused.
You make more growth, like the gardener. We must be wary, says the wooden one. We will allow no flame to pass.
Fine. I turn back to myself.
Quick question. How... The needles, how long do I feel terrible?
You're still feeling it.
Yeah. No, it's a question to the dryads. Because they shot it. They would know.
Floris flies over to you.
Oh.
And pulls one of the needles out. And then extends her hand and a flower grows up. A yellow flower.
Okay.
Smell this.
Not my finger.
And you explode. No.
No more Zacchus.
Someday I'll be able to do that. No, you feel the poison fade.
Okay. Thank you.
And she kind of smiles at you and leans in, and the rest of you see the vines kind of holding her almost childlike as she leans in towards you and just is very close to your face.
I like you.
Thank you.
And she kind of pulls back.
I like you as well. Thank you for your help.
And what of the other one? And the wooden one starts walking towards and kind of walks right by Elzera to walk up to you. Now, she's only 2 feet tall.
Right.
So she's, but at this close, you can see that her entire body is just covered with this thick black bark. And she has, in strategic points, these large, obviously poisonous spikes of thorns. Grunts. Who are you here to reap?
Oh, nobody. He's just our ally.
I have no one in mind.
So you will reap anyone?
In defense, I suppose.
He will agree to be bound.
What?
It is the only way to be safe.
When you say the Reaper, are you referring to Clark or to the weapon?
Yes.
Yes, to which? Clark or the weapon?
They are one and the same.
One for Clark, two for the weapon.
They are one and the same. There is no difference.
Clark just looks over at Zacchus.
Huh? Are you okay with this? How do you... What about the weapon? If you're bound, you can't carry it. I'd try carrying it, but it gave me a headache last time.
Clark will secure his weapons.
Okay.
About his person.
You see this one extend her hand, and her finger grows, and a vine starts growing out. Knob, knob, knob. And at each of these knobs, a spike grows. And it extends around you and starts to wrap around you. As it does, it starts to get closer and closer until it is obvious what she is doing. She is binding you with this vine. And you feel it kind of tighten in on you and then tighten and then tighten and then tighten to the point where you can feel the pinprick of the edge of those thorns on your skin.
Clark will step into it.
Okay. Leaning in?
Yeah.
All right. It hurts in a number of places. It is extraordinarily tight. You have been bound before by certain unfortunate circumstances. This is like being bound with a wet rope.
Yeah.
That as it is tightened, cuts circulation off. I am satisfied, she says forcefully.
And nothing harmful will happen to us while we are in the grove, correct?
We protect the grove.
Okay.
If the grove is protected, you should come to no harm.
Okay.
Are you okay with this, Clark?
Whatever it takes.
Well, shall we go in?
Visitors! Says Flora, strangely jubilant at this particular moment, and moving, gliding along those vines, walks straight into the wall. And as she kind of moves into the wall, you see the vines push back into an archway. The vines and the trees are curving overhead in a permanent arch tunnel that leads you through. Come on, follow me. It's not safe for long.
I'll follow.
And as they lead you in, the two others follow behind. The wooden one is keeping an eye on you and following close. The one that you were seeing before steps out to her full vision, and you can see her to be kind of almost as green like the new... vines that you had created. It seems like the spikes are also very, very small on her. And she extends her hand to you.
I shake it.
She grabs your hand and pulls you along. Takes you all in. You can feel and hear the vines closing behind you as you continue to descend. And then you see the opening of a cave in front of you, and you descend into the cave. It's absolutely pitch black for a few seconds. But then you can see a glow on the horizon.
or rather down the tunnel, as you're led deeper and deeper and deeper until finally you hear the sound of water rushing, strangely, up and to the right, and you see the glow of dozens of crystals. For Alzera is a strangely reminiscent sight. It is an underground grove, much like what was in the Padwich Glen. And
beautiful.
You hear whistling. Happy, light, halfling whistling. Coming from somewhere, echoing off the walls. The wooden one turns to you. Wait here.
I am a shadow in the dark. Nobody can see me if
it's true. Kuzumaya is kind of half seen.
I'm
half
barely visible because I want
to
be.
I'll try not to step on your.
And tail. You hear a what? Oh, visitors! Excellent. And you hear from this thick grove underneath, where you can even smell the sweetness of these thornberries. A halfling emerge, brushing his hands off on his shirt, which is somewhat worn. He's got a belt which is made of a vine that seems to twist and turn as he moves, almost as though it itself is alive. He's wearing cut-off pants. He's got nothing on his feet. Wiping off his knees as well. Well, it's always nice to have visitors. He comes walking around the corner. Hello. We've never met before, have we?
Dreams.
You
might have met her.
Have we met before?
No, but I meant I'm looking for her name.
That would be Para the Gardener.
Para, yes. Literally, as I turned the page. Para, but I've worked with Para. And she mentioned you.
He walks up to you, kind of ignoring the rest. His face has gone kind of slack at this point.
And she mentioned, I believe, it's that he had gone missing recently.
Mm-hmm.
And she was worried.
He walks up to you with a confused expression on his face. Come down here, if you don't mind. Your name is Alzera.
Yes.
Well, how do I know that? I've never met you before in my life, have I? Have we met?
I don't remember meeting.
Oh, well. I'm sure it'll come to me. Come in, friends.
Do I feel anything?
Make a perception check, we'll call it. Actually, insight. We'll make an insight.
Because I've been rolling so well with those. A nine.
Nine? There's a sense that he seems to recognize you, but he didn't remember where. But you've never seen this halfling before in your life.
So, I follow him.
Come in. And he starts to point out the grove, and he's kind of built a small gardening shed over here, and there's strange tools, a lot of them made out of the wood of the vines themselves. You can see these racks upon racks of thornberries. Is that really necessary, Terrace? And he points at the vines circling Clark. He's a reaper. He's probably here for what remains of your soul. Oh, no, he's not. Let him free. And she kind of grimaces and grunts. As you wish, gardener. And the vines fall away. And you feel a bit of freedom.
Clark will stretch.
And you can feel the glaive straightening up to the scythe position behind you.
Clark will take a few steps back. Just to show that he's not trying to be aggressive.
It looks as though Bernard himself has already paid no attention to this at this moment. Well, I assume you're here for my berries. Or maybe some leaves. I have a good crop in abundance right now.
We are looking for some of those for one of the temples, yes.
Good. Haven't been too many people around lately. I was starting to get worried. I was expecting some folks to come in a little earlier, but you're not really from around here, are you?
No.
They're probably dead.
Oh.
Or back by now.
Well, that seems
strange.
Grim?
Do you want to go home?
Home? Well, I am home. This is my home.
Back to, Vetterdren? Yes.
Oh, well, I hadn't thought of that.
I don't know if I could leave at this point. I've got so much work to do.
You do bring much happiness to the people around here, from what I've heard.
Oh, well, thank you very much. That's what I try to. It's always been my mission to make people happy.
Everything in the shadow is corrupt and decaying, but this place looks alive and well, and
how do you
do it?
Oh, green thumb, an open heart, kind mind. Don't know, really.
I go up to just some of the thorn berries, and I just kind of pet the flower.
They seem vibrant. From this world where everything has been gray and decaying and awful, they seem fresh and vibrant, and they smell rich. And the texture of the petals is as you remember it, and memory starts flooding back into you about what they had been to you.
And I just kind of start crying.
Suddenly your tears caught by a small blue flower. As Floris kind of winds yourself around you. Why do you cry? Are you trying to make the plant grow?
These were very important to someone who was important to me.
Oh. Who is that?
My fiancé.
Oh. Do you wear the ring?
Yeah.
Okay. As you're holding the flower petal, you see a vine from her kind of wrap around your arm and pull your hand up lightly.
Huh.
Come with me.
I follow.
She kind of wraps her arm around you and kind of drags you. The weird thing is, it looks like your feet never really touch the ground. It's as though the ground itself is always constantly growing up from underneath her and passing her along. And she pulls you around the winding grove. There. It's the heart of the grove. And she points up. And you can see now that the crystals have all been reflecting light coming from one central point. All coming from this one point up above you. And you can see vines have kind of grown up in, come to a certain point where the glow is, and then flourish outward. This strange H-shaped pattern. Go on.
I got it.
And you walk closer, and there's a sort of carved rock that seems to have been built as a sort of step going up to it. And as you get closer, the light is brighter, and you're having to kind of shield your eyes a little bit. Look closer. And there at the very center, where that light is glowing, where these vines are intertwined and moving upward and around it, you kind of blink because it's very familiar. It's a small metal ring, intertwined, metal of two different colors. It is the other wedding ring. Your fiancé's wedding ring. And I think that's where I'm going to close for this evening.
Oh my god.
Of course it is!
But, that is the notion for this evening. Our first attempt at streaming on Twitch. We know we don't have a lot of people who are watching on Twitch, but certainly if you did watch, or if you're watching this on YouTube later, feel free to share. twitch.tv/encaf1. Much like the youtube.com/encaf1. This is an experiment. We've been doing this for quite a while via just sort of recordings and then live streaming on YouTube, then live streaming on Twitch. We're not sure where this experiment will take us, but hopefully we did okay. If you did enjoy it, let us know. What are some of the ways people can let us know about this?
You can like the Facebook page, Legend of the Drowned Isles, which is linked somewhere. and there is a group that is Watchers of the Drowned Isles. We also do some talking.
Bar mitzvahs, parties, birthdays.
and yeah.
Okay. And if people like it on Twitch, I'm not sure what they can do at this moment, other than come back and watch. Generally every Sunday afternoon.
I think you can follow.
You can follow, that's what it is. So you get a little notification every time we'll do this. If they want to like it on YouTube, what do they do?
Oh, they hit the like button. That's the one thing they do. But also they can subscribe to see more videos and hit the bell to make sure you see all those videos when they get loaded up.
And also share with your friends.
Yeah. Yeah, we hope that everybody would have a chance to enjoy this weird little game of mine. Mm-hmm. That seems kind of weird to say. But for those of you who are kind of wondering, I'm paying off some plot lines that have happened to these characters for a long time. So
this is like...
character creation stuff going on here.
It's only taken me 3 years to get back to this point. So, again, thanks for watching, and we'll do it again, I believe, next week.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Bye-bye.